This is Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket with Don Shane and Bo Schembechler.
One more game for Michigan to get by before the most anticipated college football game of the year. One last game for John L. Smith at Spartan Stadium. It won't be easy for his guys to beat Minnesota. Hello, everybody. I'm Don. He's Bo. Welcome to the Big Ten Ticket. I think back to what you said last week, and you said, if you don't get better, even against inferior competition, then you get worse. Did Michigan get worse against Ball State?
Yes, because they didn't come out of that game feeling good about what they did. They didn't improve in any particular phase of the game that I saw. Mm-hmm. And the most fortunate thing about that is Ohio State might have been worse.
That's right.
So they certainly didn't improve at all.
You know, but when you look at what happened, their defense against the rush was terrific. They rushed for 352 yards. They had a 31-12 lead in the third quarter, and then other guys played. They let in a couple long passes, and all of a sudden it's a game again. So if you analyze it that way, yeah, it's really not as bad as people are making it out to be, is
yeah
it?
Well, I always kid Lloyd Carr about substitution in games in which you thought you gained control. When I was coaching, I never wanted to weaken my defense at all during the game, because I don't want anybody to score on. I mean, that's where you put in secondary backs where they throw the ball over their head and run for a touchdown, I mean, that's pretty sorry. And that was my theory. But Lloyd's a generous guy. He substitutes all these guys. And
you know, my card had a fumble that they can't even call a fumble. But it's really hard to criticize this kid when you go 666 or so carries without fumbling the ball, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he felt badly about it, but come on. That's amazing when you think
about it.
Yeah,
that was a crazy play, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
Oh, geez. Well, you start off the game, you give him 9 points. You know,
The Chad Haney interception thing was not exactly a great pass either.
That wasn't. I don't know what he was thinking there, because they had two guys there. They could have decided which one was going to intercept.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was a bad decision.
You mentioned the thing about the defense and Kidd and Lloyd about making sure you're still in control. When you're sitting there watching, and he's got some backups in, and they go those two long passes. I mean, he's trying to get experience for those kids, right? I mean, he's trying to do some things to help his football team down the road. He feels like he's got control.
Well, let me tell you something. He didn't help those two kids because they didn't sleep Saturday night after they hit those bombs over their head.
Right.
Yeah.
So it doesn't work for them. They play all right.
You have to do some substituting. I don't argue that. But I don't want to give them a full quarter, because something like this could happen.
Certainly.
We could have lost that game.
But you didn't.
No.
But didn't.
That's neither here nor there. But if you read the score, if I'm out in California and I read the score, I say, what the hell? Ball State's as good as Michigan.
Yeah.
Well, that's not true.
It's deceiving. For sure. The Michigan players were not happy after the game, that's for sure. Not happy on Monday at the weekly press conference either. They realized what happened in that game and what needs to be done today.
It was a little bit of a wake-up call for us. You know, we got to keep doing what we've been doing all season, which is running the ball, stopping the run, not giving up big plays, you know, that kind of stuff. So we just got to keep doing that. It's definitely kind of a little bit of a wake-up call, and it's perfect timing, really. We got these next two big games coming up.
Well, we're definitely going to practice better this week. We're gonna be focused, fired up, and we want to take that win last week behind us. You know, all the mistakes we made and everything, and we want to play perfect. We want to get better and really be strong for last stretch of the season. So we really want to come out, correct the mistakes, make sure we play perfect and play like we know we can.
I think we just want to go out and play like we've played all year. I don't know, per se, vindicate. That last game was over with. We put it behind us. It's just something we can learn from. But we want to go out and get back to what we were doing before and just try to accomplish our goals for this week against a very good team.
You know, since you won the game and you're still number 2 in the country, in a way, Isn't this kind of good for Lloyd? Because he's got their attention now after a game like that and practices and what's coming up with Minnesota and then Ohio State.
Yes, I think that's true. And I think they had a little more intensity in practice on Tuesday because of that. You know, it's close to the Ohio State game. I mean, you can talk about it if you want to be, but if you want to get there, you got to beat everybody else to do it. Mm-hmm. Now, you go down to Indiana. Now, I'm not saying that Indiana can beat Michigan, but they're scary. Mm-hmm. And you don't want to make any mistakes, and you want to get some momentum down in there. You don't want to beat... You don't want to beat Indiana. You want to overwhelm them. And then when you come out of there, we're ready for them.
And this week against Indiana, Manningham played some last week, but now he's back starting full force, ready to go. That is huge for this offense.
Yeah, I think it would help the program if he'd throw him a pass. You know, he played in the game and they didn't throw him a pass. I think... I would like, and I know you'll laugh at this, but I personally would like to see the pass more. True, because, we're getting a little too much stereotype with the running. I mean, I like running, don't get me wrong.
Believe me.
But this is a team who has a quarterback and skilled receivers, mm-hmm. and as I look out there on those wideouts, there's only one guy on them. One-on-one on Manningham, on Breston.
Arrington.
They can't cover those guys. Why don't we take advantage of that?
I think you probably will.
Hopefully
against Ohio State, that's for sure. All right, Bo and I are just getting started. When we come back, we will touch on John L. Smith, another loss last weekend. He'll try to get a win in his final home game as MSU's head coach today against Minnesota. We'll get Bo's thoughts on this Indiana team, an improved team, but they certainly got embarrassed against the Gophers last weekend. And I can't wait to hear what Bo says on Joe Paterno, his sideline injury and his desire to coach today. We're back with the Big Ten Ticket after this, so please stay with us.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket is brought to you in part by the University of Michigan Health System and by your Metro Detroit Ford dealers. Think Ford first.
Let's go back to 1987 in Bloomington. Yeah, it was raining like crazy. I'm sure Bo remembers this game against Bill Mallory. Last time Indiana beat Michigan. Hoosiers got this early TD pass from Schnell to Jones. Back came Michigan on a Brown to Kolasar pass, but they lost 14-10. Michigan has won 29 of the last 30 times they have played, and that's the loss. And you were coaching that team, and I'm here to tell you that I think that's unfair, that you were like 20-1 against that team. And our producers, Patrick and Brian, picked that game to show. Now, that's unfair to me. I don't think we should have done that to you.
I thought I burned that. but I guess I didn't. How about Patrick? He can find out, you know what?
It's terrible, isn't it?
Oh,
now,
yeah,
let me show you. Let me show you.
The next thing, the one thing I know, he isn't going to find a game against Northwestern that I lost.
Because you didn't.
Because I didn't.
All right, let me show you the one that I wanted to show from the Michigan-Indiana game. This one I know you remember. Now, this is what we should be showing people, the Anthony Carter touchdown to win that game.
Yeah.
That
was a great play, wasn't it?
That was a great one, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Final seconds. 21 all. Yeah. Boom. Yeah. Anthony Carter, you didn't think you were going to win that game, did you, on that play? Did you call that play?
Well, I didn't think we'd win it, but I thought we'd go.
Did you call that play? Was that your design? Was that your call?
I...
Be honest now.
I don't recall.
You don't recall?
Let's give it to somebody else on the staff.
Let them have it, huh? That was fun, though.
Well, let's put it this way. You know they were going to play a deep zone defense. There was going to be a gigantic hole in the middle. You have one guy on your team that if you give him the ball in the middle of that field,
you got a chance.
And they got three guys back here cupping him, who can escape that?
Anthony Carter.
Anthony Carter. That's
one of your,
the play you want.
Maybe your all-time favorite Michigan player. One of your favorites,
well,
by far.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
All right.
The Michigan players know that this today is not an automatic win. Indiana is an improved team. It's a game that they should win. It's a game they expect to win, especially knowing what is at stake.
Shoot, you know, the Big Ten championship, national championship, and those are our two biggest goals. And, you know, we set those goals at the beginning of the season. And, you know, now that's the end of the season and everything's starting to shape up, we don't want to lose focus and hurt ourselves and make those mistakes to lose. So that's why I really think everybody's going to refocus this week and get prepared for this team, because Indiana's a motivated team and they want to make a bowl and they only need one more win for that. So they're going to come out with everything they have against us. So we gotta play our best game.
Plain and simple, a loss today just ruins their season, right? I mean, come on, you can't do this.
No, this cannot happen. But you're going to have everybody. Now, I think that the Michigan team is pretty healthy. I think they got most of their guys back. I don't know whether they have the tight end back yet, but...
Well, I think Massey's back, but maybe not Ecker.
Yeah. So everybody has got to contribute and to go out there and play this. This is a championship game. That's what it is. And they have to win it.
All right, let's talk about this quarterback at Indiana, because in the past, not necessarily with this defense, but in the past, they've had a tough time with scrambling quarterbacks. This redshirt freshman, Kellen Lewis, pretty good player.
I think he's a terrific young kid. The trend nowadays is to get guys like this who have the ability to run, improvise, maybe run an option play, and just drive you nuts. Now, this guy's got the great 6'7" receiver.
Hardy.
This guy
is... James Hardy.
Oh, Hardy is special.
He scares you, huh?
Oh, he's special. You go out there on a 5'11", 6-foot back, he's going to have a hard time playing against this guy. Mm-hmm. And that one scares me.
The head coach, Terry Heppner, has done a pretty good job. And he's an interesting story in itself, because he's had the brain surgery and come back. He deserves a lot of credit for what he's done.
Oh,
with his
I'd take
team.
My hat off to him. I think he's done a marvelous job. I mean, what tougher circumstances could you have? Take the job at Indiana to start with,
right,
and then have the medical problems he's had, continue to coach, win some big games, and find this nice young quarterback, mm-hmm, nice big receiver. He's going to be around at least for another year. Indiana is a program that's interesting to watch, and let's hope that it's not too interesting.
At least today. When we come back, we'll talk about MSU and John L. and Lloyd with some thoughts on schools coming after his assistants. That's next on The Ticket. Don't go away.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket is brought to you in part by ABC Warehouse, the closest thing to wholesale.
Look at it as a positive rather than a negative, and put your arms around the kids. You worry about the effect on those guys more than anything, and you know, try to just, come on guys, let's go. Is this gonna happen? You try to reflect to them, oh, this is part of life. This is the things that you're gonna go through as well. And let's make the most out of it, let's go.
Well, he's trying to make it a positive life lesson kind of thing for his kids, what he is going through, but it has to be an incredibly emotional, difficult time for him to put up that front and still coach those kids.
Well, he's been a successful coach all his life, and this job has, he hasn't been able to handle it, and it's too bad, because I'm not sure it's him. But then again, when you don't win sufficiently enough, why, they're going to move you out.
Yeah.
It's tough now that he has to coach these last few games as a lame duck coach.
Yeah.
That's hard.
All right, lots of rumors, speculation that MSU might be interested in Michigan defensive coordinator Ron English. Lloyd was asked what he does when schools call and ask permission to speak to one of his assistants.
Well, I just don't take them. No, there's nothing that I would rather see than to have guys on our staff have the opportunity to move on in head coaching positions. It's one of the advantages of coaching here, And I think there's a lot of guys on this staff capable of being head coaches.
And we'll let Lloyd take this discussion one step further. He was asked if it would be weird if a Michigan assistant ended up as Michigan State's head coach.
That'd be fun, wouldn't it? Well, you know, Biggie Munn, I think he's the winningest coach in the history of Michigan State, coached here for Fritz Kreisler. So I can remember Bill McCartney, when he was an assistant here, expressed an interest in that job, and it just made a lot of people very angry. But the truth is, it's a great job, and there's a lot of people that would love to be the head coach there.
All right, two questions, or a two-part question, first of all. One, is it a distraction for Ron English's name to be brought up as a possible guy to run Michigan State's program? And two, would you let a school talk to one of your guys' assistants during the season?
Well, let's start with the second question first. No, they are not going to talk to one of my assistants during the season. That is unethical.
Okay.
And I don't want any contact at all. Whether one of my assistants goes somewhere else as a head coach, I think that's wonderful. And just like Lloyd said, I've had them go all over the country as head coaches.
Well, you were an assistant at Ohio State and ended up at Michigan, even though you had the Miami stop in between.
That's right. And Woody wasn't happy about that at all. But anyway,
is it a distraction for Ron English's name to be brought up?
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. It's a distraction. It's not his fault. But if Michigan State had contacted him or tried to contact him, that is unethical. You don't do that during the season. And that's my big
For the record, he has said he's gotten no call.
Well, then just let him talk.
Right.
You know.
Right. Let him be on the up and up, and then maybe when the season...
I'll tell you what. Remember when they came out with all this stuff that I'm going to Texas A&M?
I do.
My, geez, poor little Bo, he's just... I mean, I'm not trying to get out of here. I'm not interested in going anywhere.
Right.
All of a sudden, somebody from down in Texas says, you know, Bo Schembechler's our top prospect. Next thing you know, it's all over up here. You remember that.
I do. They were throwing a lot of money at you, as I recall.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were.
Almost
millions.
Almost as much as you're making.
When we come back, Bo on Joe Paterno, that is. He's 79 and feisty as ever, and an unusual player of the week this week. It doesn't go to an individual, but rather a group. I'll explain that. We're back with the ticket after this. Hang with us. Each week, Bo and I select a player of the game. It's brought to you by the University of Michigan Health System. This week, we've decided to give it to the entire offensive line. That's right. Those guys did a really nice job protecting Henny and an excellent job opening holes for Mike Hart and the other running backs. Michigan rushed for 352 yards against Ball State. That stat almost got lost in that close win over Ball State. Let's talk about Joe Paterno. He's 79. He gets hit in the sidelines. He fractures the tibia. He tears some ligaments. He wants to coach. Finally, the doctor says the other day, you're not going to go anywhere near there and coach. What are your thoughts on Joe as you watch this play? And the fact that he wanted to be there so badly speaks a lot about him, I guess.
Well, yeah, Joe's a heck of a good guy. But let me ask you this question. Here's a guy who's got a pretty serious injury.
Yeah.
And they'd like to have him stay at home. Now, do you honestly believe that they need Joe Paterno to beat Temple?
No, I don't.
No.
No, I don't.
We could put you out there as the head coach of Penn State and
beat
Temple.
I'll do it.
Yeah. So I can't understand that one at all, other than Joe wants to, I gotta go out.
You realize in 41 years of head coach, he's missed one game back in 1977. Yeah. His son was in an accident. This is only second time. That's an amazing record.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Well, that's why he's still coaching.
Yeah.
Because his health is held up.
Did you see the statue on campus, by the way? We got some video of the statue on campus.
Yeah, I saw
that. They wrapped his left knee.
Yeah. Oh, Joe.
All right, listen to Lloyd talk about Paterno and that play and really how dangerous it is on the sideline.
I've taken a few shots, and it's no fun because the truth is it happens so fast that you really don't have time in some cases to get out of the way. And it's a frightening thing because these are big guys and they have helmets on. And you get hit by a helmet, I mean, you can die. I mean, it's a dangerous place.
That, of course, that was video of John Falk getting hit a couple
yeah,
years ago.
Right.
Did you ever have anything quite like that happen to you?
I was too nifty. You know, as they came, I jumped out of the way. No, I got hit a few times. I got hit more in practice than I did in the game.
Took some good shots in practice,
didn't you? Yeah, because, you know, there are a lot of things going on around you when you're coaching, and if some guy strays after a pass, or something, that's what happened. One time, Tommy Darden hit me. And I had my back to him, and he was running to catch a pass, so he didn't see me. And wham, he hit me right in the back. He had full pads on, and it almost killed me.
All right, Ohio State, Northwestern, Michigan, Indiana, both win. Assuage everybody's feelings. Both win. Both will go 11-0, and that sets up the game that everybody wants to see next week, right? Not a problem, right?
Well, it's not a problem if they both win.
Right, but you anticipate them both winning.
I anticipate both of them winning. Now, if either one of those teams wants to win the big game,
yeah,
the national championship,
yeah, yeah,
they had better look good and win big.
Gotcha. Just a reminder, next week on our show, we will be talking for an hour. Michigan and Ohio State, we'll look at it. It'll be an hour show. It will run right after the 11 o'clock news on Friday night. And again at 11 a.m. Saturday morning. The game's at 3:30 only right here on Channel 7. I'll be live in Columbus Friday night and Saturday after the game. I want to thank everybody for watching. Bo and I hope to see you next Saturday before the Michigan-Ohio State game. See you later.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket is brought to you in part by the University of Michigan Health System and by your Metro Detroit Ford dealers. Think Ford first.
This telecast is available on ESPN HD, presented by Pioneer Plasma. And the snap of autumn is in the Indiana air, a 40-degree Saturday afternoon as the Hoosiers make their walk into Memorial Stadium, hoping to spoil next week's epic showdown between number one Ohio State and number two Michigan. The Hoosiers also hope to make history by making Chad Henne and the Wolverines the highest-ranked team ever to lose to Indiana. Is Big Ten weather, damp, chilly, and breezy as we welcome you to Memorial Stadium in Bloomington, Indiana. ESPN College Football presented by Cars.com. Number two, Michigan, tries to stay perfect, getting set for their meeting with Ohio State, which likewise tries to get to 11-0 this afternoon as the Buckeyes pay a visit to Northwestern. Wisconsin already advancing to 10-1 with their victory at Iowa. Welcome to Bloomington. I'm Dave Barnett, along with Bill Curry. And so far, both Michigan and Ohio State have played their roles to perfection. Can they do it one more week? In the case of the Wolverines today, the job should be a little bit easier as they welcome back, really fully into the game plan, Mario Manningham.
Yeah, Mario Manningham, they call him Mr. Wonderful around. All you hear from his teammates is how much they respect him. Same thing from the coaches, but it's not just because of his performance. Yes, he averages 22 yards every time he touches the ball, and yes, he has 9 touchdowns, most of them of the deep variety, but he's also highly respected, Dave, because he has incredible work ethic, and he's a terrific leader for this football team.
And just his presence back on the field has got to make people like Mike Hart and Chad Henne's jobs much easier.
Yeah. Mike Hart is the heart and soul of the revived running attack for this Michigan team. He's averaging almost 5 yards per carry. Chad Henne's numbers, not quite as impressive as some of the top quarterbacks around the country, but when you look at the W's, they look mighty good. 10 wins this year against no losses. That defense, Lamar Woodley, is a dominating player. He can take over a game himself from his defensive end position, and he has a lot of help from his mates.
And for Indiana to have a prayer of staying close is not as impossible as you might I think, if Kellen Lewis and James Hardy have the type day they're capable of.
Kellen Lewis is not your typical redshirt freshman quarterback. He has awareness. Yes, he has a marvelous arm and a quick release. He has good feet and he runs well. But his best asset is his field awareness, and he knows where that big guy, Mr. Hardy, is. They've teamed up for 9 touchdowns this year as well. They'll have to have a superb day to be in this game, Dave.
Indiana has proven capable of the upset. Ask Iowa, ask Michigan State to try to knock off number 2 Michigan today. Well, that would be historic. Kickoff coming up.
ESPN's College Football, brought to you by Verizon Wireless. Cece's Pizza, where you can enjoy our endless buffet of pizza, pasta, salad, and desserts. And the City Premier Pass credit card. Rewarding. Very, very, very rewarding.
Reese Davis, Mark May, Lou Holtz with you here. You see, we're in the middle. We're watching Michigan and Indiana on ESPN. Some are able to see Ohio State and Northwestern. That's on ABC and HD. Lou, what are some of the things you're looking for in this game? It'll be an indication of what's going to happen next week in Columbus.
Well, I think, first of all, Michigan has not been able to defend Troy Smith over the last couple of years. Kellen Lewis is an exciting quarterback. He can run and scramble very much like Troy Smith. So how well they defend Troy Smith is going to be critical in ascertaining how well they defend Troy Smith next week.
I think the key for Michigan in this game is wide receiver Mariel Manningham. Can he get back to the playing ability he had the first 6 games where he had 9 touchdown receptions? If he can do that this week and show that he's got the same abilities, I think Ohio State has to look out for the wide receiver Mariel Manningham because he's awesome when he's healthy.
Oh, you see the Hoosiers running onto the field. And Tressel stalking the sideline on ABC. We're going to keep you up to date on everything that's going on in the Ohio State game all day long, guys.
Back in Memorial Stadium, Bloomington, Indiana, just about set for the kickoff. Lloyd Carr in his 12th year at Michigan, hoping to repeat what he did 9 years ago, and that is finish off a perfect national championship season. Big rebound from last year's disappointment, 7-5, which finished with an Alamo Bowl loss to Nebraska. And he takes on Terry Heppner, second-year head coach of the Hoosiers. 9-12, the native of Woodburn, Indiana, who won consecutive Mid-American Conference East championships and took Miami of Ohio to consecutive bowls, earning him the head coaching job here in Bloomington. And Billy says his goals are very simple, 100% graduation and the Rose Bowl. And they shoot for perfection, but they settle for excellence.
And people might chuckle when they hear words like that, but this guy has pulled it off. And what he's done with his personal life and his personal situation, having 2 brain surgeries this year and out here coaching his team, he's got to be the number one inspirational story in college football this year.
2 surgeries in a 9-month span, 1 for a tumor, 1 they were afraid might be for recurrence of a tumor, but it turned out to be for scar tissue. Chad Henne, his 35th consecutive start, the junior from Pennsylvania, first quarterback in Big Ten history to win the conference as a true freshman, first since Rick Leach to start the opening game of a Michigan season as a freshman. And the 3rd winningest active quarterback in college football, going for his 27th victory today and 34 starts. Only Jared Zabransky of Boise State and John Stocko of Wisconsin have more career victories. Boise glad to have Mariel Manningham back. They eased him back a little bit onto the field last week against Ball State. Not really part of the game plan, but that should change today. Missed 3 games. Knee surgery after the Michigan State game. The 3rd leading receiver, 24 catches, and at 22 yards per catch and 9 touchdowns, all 9 of which, Bill, happened from outside 20 yards.
When he goes deep, he makes me think of Larry Fitzgerald, except he has a lot more speed than Fitzgerald, the great receiver formerly of Pittsburgh and now playing in the National Football League at Arizona. But this guy also inspires. There's something his charisma brings out in his team that I think is as important as his performance. I say that again and again, but that's all you hear from his teammates and coaches.
Indiana has won the toss and elected to defer. Michigan will receive the opening kick at Memorial Stadium. 59th meeting. Michigan predictably is dominated. 49 wins, 9 losses. They're 15-2 here in Bloomington. They won 14 in a row, 29 of the last 30 meetings. Only Indiana win 14-10 here, 1987. Lloyd Carr perfect against Indiana, 9-0. Winning in Ann Arbor last week, or last year, 41-17. Michigan senior receiving leader, Steve Breston, school kick return record holder. He has also caught 45 passes, still looking for his first touchdown as a wide receiver this year. Preston dropping back deep for the Wolverines. We'll try to keep their date with destiny. Ohio State needs to do the same thing at Northwestern today. The Big Ten will have a first ever 1-2, undefeated versus undefeated, Ohio State at Michigan next week, 3:30 on ABC. So we're set to go. Austin Starr with the opening kick, and he drives one low, and it'll be fielded at the 5 by Breston. And Breston angling his way back across the field before he's finally chased down by Will Patterson at the 35-yard line. Chad Henne thus set to go to work. He's at 61% of his passes, 16 touchdowns, 6 interceptions. And is second in Michigan history, averaging 207 passing yards per game. Fastest Wolverine quarterback ever to 3,000 yards, 4,000, 5,000, and most recently 6,000 career yards. Former Pennsylvania Gatorade Player of the Year. And the Wolverines starting at the 34. Mike Hart in the one-back set and at the 37-yard line.
Number 20, Mike Hart, the ball carrier.
The Nivea for Men Michigan lineup today, featuring one of the top offensive linemen in the country, Jake Long, the senior left tackle. Captain Mike DeBoard says, the best offensive lineman in the country, DeBoard, Michigan's offensive coordinator. And not just because of the X's and the O's and the technique, but also because he is an incredible leader for this Michigan team. Second down and 7. And Henne on the roll, wide open. Breston uncovered and crosses midfield before he's wrestled out of the 45.
Henne's pass complete to number 15.
A gain of 18.
For Wolverine fans, you recognize this play. Breston, nice job. Just trail route there out into the open zone. It was a bootleg, which caused the linebackers to freeze their position, so there was nobody out there in the flat. Nice throw and catch. And easy completion to get started for Henne. Important for his confidence.
And as you notice, we'll keep the Ohio State Northwestern score up there in the upper left-hand corner of the screen so you can watch this game and keep track of that one. Henne just in time to beat the blitz, and the catch made. Manningham, the target for the first time at the 38-yard line, hit immediately by Tracy Porter.
It may sound very strange for me to say that Henne needs confidence in his early throws, but there have been games when he started very poorly, as in Notre Dame, thrown touchdown interceptions. Nice pressure there by Geno Johnson, strong side linebacker number 56 for Indiana.
Manningham good for 8 yards on his first catch of the day. And second down and 2 on this opening possession for the Wolverines. Hart trying the right side, bounces off the initial hit, and then cuts it back for the first down and a lot more inside the 30. About 90% of that on his own from Mike Hart. Nivea for Men defensive lineup for Indiana. Curlew, Kramer, Brown, and Kendall are up front. And under the gun in the secondary, two good ones, Will Myers and Tracy Porter. Myers, captain, leader of the secondary, and academic All-America in accounting, of their leading tackler with 69, and along with Porter, interception leaders. They each have 3. Here's first and 10, and the swing pass is almost a backwards pass, incomplete, intended for Breston. Henne letting that one go, Bill, right along a parallel line of the line of scrimmage.
Looked like that he was not really as focused on his receiver as he was on the idea of making sure that it was not a backward pass, and it killed his accuracy on that one.
Indiana has struggled. That's definitely the word on the defensive side of the ball. Fourth from the bottom of the country in pass efficiency. 116 out of 119. There's lots of room again for Hart, and he cuts it back and is down near the 10. Another first down. Curlew chased him down after a gain of 17.
This outstanding offensive line just makes things happen. Watch Adam Krause, number 57, just absolutely caves his man there, and he's the guy that gives the room, blocking on Greg Brown, who's just kind of a load himself, a big guy, but a nice job by Krause. And the reason the guys love Hart so much is what you just saw. He always makes more than the play gives him.
Junior from Syracuse, New York, again called on. And picks up about five, gets it inside the 7-yard line. Hit there by Will Patterson, the weak side linebacker. Hart, Michigan career leader, 113 yards per game.
And listen to this, Dave, 668 offensive touches, now over 670 without a fumble that's been recovered by the other side. He's put it on the ground a time or two, but he's always come up with it.
Better than 8 yards per carry here in this opening drive. And this time met by five or six tacklers. Still manages to get it just inside the 5-yard line. And from there, it'll be third and a little less than three for a first down and a little less than five for a touchdown. Opening possession of the game for number two, Michigan. Michigan. Question, Lloyd Carr's best team bill since 1997. And the big reason right there, they are 92%. Inside the red zone for the year.
They are 92%, but they only got 20 touchdowns and all those opportunities, and they'd like to have more.
Penny with a change at the line decides to give to Hart. And Hart is going to be very close, should have the first down. They need the two, and they're going to mark him just inside the two.
20 Hart on the carry.
Jamie Curlew from left defensive end leading the Indiana surge against Mike Hart, but where they mark it, it's first and goal just outside the one.
Again on those red zone stats, Michigan has not been as good scoring touchdowns down here as they would like to be. Only around 60%. And that's how many red shirts it takes to get that little guy on the ground. And he still gets it down to the one.
Yeah, 5'9", 196. You'd think he's 30 or 40 pounds bigger than that. Judging by how hard he is to tackle. The fade into the corner of the end zone for Adrian Arrington, and he brings it in for the Michigan touchdown.
And his pass complete to number 16, Adrian Arrington. Number 9, Tracy Porter.
And he drops it in over Tracy Porter perfectly for the sixth touchdown, all in the last five Big Ten games for Arrington.
Now, everybody at Michigan is happy about this if you're not Bo Schembechler, because on the 1-yard line, he wouldn't like this play call, but it's great execution. Arrington catching the ball right over the best defender that Indiana has.
For the extra point, Garrett Rivas makes it 7-0. You think Bo's still that picky? Extra, I mean, points are points. Bo knows that.
Bo's watching right now, and he's gnashing his teeth. Bo, this is how some people play. They got great skill. They score now. Bo wants to knock it in there, and he always did.
Well, and he tossed it in there to Adrian Arrington, the junior from Cedar Rapids, Iowa, and Michigan scores on its first possession. Old hat from Michigan scoring first now in 9 of their 11 games this year. Dominating first quarter team Henning hitting Arrington.
This is perfect execution, and I do mean perfect, because Porter's got good coverage, but the throw is over the outside shoulder so that Arrington's the only guy that had a chance to come down with it.
Took less than 5 minutes for Michigan to score on its opening possession. And the kick by Rivas down to Jakeen Gilmore at the 6. Indiana, a great kick return team this year, and Gilmore will start them out at the 31-yard line. Let's get an update from Reese Davis in the studio.
All right, Dave, just seconds before Michigan scored, Ohio State against Northwestern. Now, I know you're concerned about Ginn and Gonzalez, but you got to guard Brian Hartline at least a little bit. Troy Smith to Hartline, and the Buckeyes take a 7-0 lead.
Yeah, almost simultaneous to the Wolverine touchdown here. And again, we'll keep that score up in one corner of your screen. 7-0 Ohio State. As we keep this score in the opposite corner, and Indiana with its first possession now, with redshirt freshman quarterback Kellen Lewis out of Jacksonville, Florida, wasting no time before tossing one up deep, intended for Gilmore and broken up by Leon Hall, the outstanding corner for Michigan.
So what do you do if Leon Hall is one of the better corners in the country? You go after him on the very first play, but you hope he doesn't come down with the football. He very nearly did just that. I think it's a good idea, though. I think you just loosen it up and get after him early and make it clear that we're not here just to get through the day. We're going to try to win the game.
Gilmore, more the DB than Leon Hall was on that first down play. And under pressure, Lewis forced to throw that one away as Rondale Biggs was bearing down on it. 396 total yards for Kellen Lewis against the Golden Gophers last week, most since Antoine Randall L. back in 1999. 321 through the air, 75 on the ground for Lewis, the fifth best individual day in Indiana history. And he looks across the line today and he sees maybe the most dangerous defensive lineman in the country this year, Lamar Woodley.
Well, if there's one more dangerous than Lamar, it is his buddy Alan Branch, number 80, who's lined up on the nose of the center right now. What a load these guys are.
Woodley, the Big Ten sack leader with 11. Lewis steps up, feels pressure, and goes down to the 23. Alan Branch, you just talked about him. Branch, the junior from Rio Rancho, New Mexico, with the sack.
Please try to grasp, folks. Number 80 is 6'6". He weighs 330 pounds, and he can run as fast as Kellen Lewis. He was a great basketball player in high school. He ran the ball from running back in high school in New Mexico. I don't know where a guy like that comes from other than New Mexico.
Tyson Beatty, who comes from Australia, sends that one down for a fair catch to Breston at the 38, 39-yard punt with fairly significant wind at his back. So the Big Ten with Michigan and Ohio State trying to stay perfect. Wisconsin, a very quiet, almost uncredited 10-1. Only lost to number one Ohio State. They should be ranked a lot higher than 16, you'd figure. And the rest of the updated Big Ten standings. Iowa with a home loss to the Badgers, falling to a very disappointing 6-5. So Michigan second possession. Ohio State already leading at Northwestern now 13-0. Here's Hart dodging more red jerseys and picking up a yard where there really was none there to be picked up.
And those are the things that never get in the books for great running backs. Hart should have had a 4-yard loss there, and they come up 2nd and 9. So they got a chance to keep this drive alive because he made something out of nothing.
Lloyd Carr has the riches behind Hart. He can play three talented backups whenever Hart needs a breather. Kevin Grady, Brandon Miner, and Jerome Jackson. Hart all the way so far. Henny with a fake to him. And then the throw to Carson Butler is tight end. That's sniffed out pretty well at the 44 by the strong safety, Troy Grossfield. It'll be third down. 15th catch of the year for the tight end Butler.
People who recall the 97 championship year for the Michigan Wolverines, this was one of their favorite plays to Jeremy Tooman. Brian Greasy to Jeremy Tooman. DeBoard is back as the coordinator, and the boot is back. He calls it a waggle. You can call it either. We got a man down on the field.
Joe Kramer.
Joe Kramer,
who is the junior defensive tackle from Urbana, Ohio.
Looks like Joe's going to be okay, but at any rate, that was a staple of that 97 Michigan offense, and you haven't seen it much in recent years, and of course, it's been revived by Mike DeBoard, the fine offensive coordinator.
Well, Butler, of the five tight ends they've played, is by far the one he trusts the most, 15 catches. Brian Thompson, Chris McLaurin, no catches between them. Tyler Ecker has 3. Mike Massey has 7. And Butler that time set up a 3rd and 4. Michigan from its 44. Manningham going in motion. Henning with all day. And the throw juggled and then caught by Manningham, but he is driven out of bounds a yard shy of the marker. And Michigan forced to punt for the first time. Adam McClurg rushing over from middle linebacker to catch up with the speedy wideout Manningham.
Wonderful job by McClurg on the crossing route. He's in a zone. He sees Manningham coming across underneath. Keeps his feet. Manningham with the juggle, knocked out of bounds, fourth and short. And it looks like Michigan's going to at least go up and see if they can get Indiana to jump off sides. All kind of little trickery that goes on in today's football.
Now Michigan, one of the best teams in the country at this, along with everything else they do well, converting fourth downs. They need a full yard here, and they're not just trying to get Indiana to jump. They didn't need to. As they go to the power running of Hart behind the fullback Obi Olibo, and he goes straight to the secondary and easily picks up the fourth and one.
You'll love watching the fullback here. This is a little old style Michigan, number 40 Olibo. Nice job, kept his feet moving, good block on McClurg by the center Mark Beal, number 54.
Even though they snapped that one in their own end of the field, the Wolverines never hesitate. They go for it, and they get it on fourth and one. And so Henny with a fresh set of downs. Again, plenty of time to sit back and pick out Adrian Arrington, who has the Michigan first down. He picks up 11 here. Let's check in with Reese Davis for a SportsCenter in-game update.
All right, David, does not appear that the Buckeyes are at all interested in stumbling before the collision in Columbus next week. Antonio Pittman, who's closing in on 1,000 yards for the season, scores against Northwestern. Number one, up by two touchdowns.
That didn't take long. Michigan didn't take long to go up 7-0 here on their first possession. Driving here on their second possession as one of Hart's backups, Jerome Jackson, breaks tackles and reaches the 21-yard line, picks up 16. The senior from Saginaw, Michigan, and again, Adam McClurg had to range far from his middle linebacker spot.
Jerome Jackson, a journeyman senior, breaking tackles, getting a chance to get in a football game. It's an important game regardless of who the opposition is, and a nice job again by the offensive line, especially in this case Adam Krause, number 57, the left guard.
Jackson earned some time early at his best day against Ball State, 6 carries, 68 yards in the win last week. But Hart right back in, and Mike Hart cuts that one down to the 15.
For 20, Hart, the ball carrier.
Jamie Curlew,
57, Curlew,
the redshirt freshman defensive end from Orlando, on the tackle. Michigan welcoming back to what they say is pretty much full health Mario Manningham. He was on the field at times last week against Ball State, but he didn't look like this Mario Manningham.
No, he just makes people look ridiculous, and then he makes circus catches, and it all looks so easy for him. It's just an amazing gift he has.
So a gain of 6 for Hart on first down, 2nd and 4. 5.5 minutes of the first. Henny play action. Into the end zone. Incomplete. As Will Myers comes over to make the play in the deep corner on the ball intended for Butler, the tight end.
What a nice job by Will Myers here, because this is a well-thrown pass. There's only been one ball today that was not a well-thrown pass by Henny. Butler with a chance to come down. Will Myers all over the field making tackles. He is the leading tackler on this football team, which is no longer a disgrace for a defense to have your free safety. A lot of tackles are funneled to the free safety.
Here's a 3rd and 4 for Michigan. Henny. Complete inside the 5-yard line. 1st and goal on the catch by Arrington. They pick up 11 yards.
Number 39, Will Myers making a stop.
Arrington having a big day already, coming across. Nice protection. It takes time to throw that dig. That's called a deep inside. The acronym DIG. Myers there for the tackle, but not before the first down.
Arrington, who in the absence of Manningham became Michigan's second leading receiver over the last couple of weeks. So 1st and goal. And just a yard this time for Mike Hart. McClurg comes up
helped out by Keith Burris.
For the Hoosiers, Adam McClure making the stop.
Second and goal from there. Indiana trying to avoid falling 14-0 down. In their final home game of the year, Parents Weekend in Bloomington. Final home game of the second season as the Hoosiers head coach for Terry Heppner. No stopping the Michigan offense so far. Indiana three and out, the only time they had it. Again, they call on Hart, and again, Hart powers after contact forward for another Wolverine touchdown. Will Myers had him, but he could not stop him.
Number 40, Obi Olibo again, the fine fullback who comes in. He just accelerates and knocks people on the ground. This time it was Troy Grossfield, number 5. The strong safety who came up to try to make the play, but he ran into a truck.
And that's Mike Hart with his 11th touchdown of the year. Revis makes it 14-0 Wolverines. 4.5 to go, first quarter. 2 Michigan possessions and 2 Michigan touchdowns. So they have their way here in Bloomington so far.
ESPN's College Football is presented by Cars.com. Find the right car for you, Cars.com. And in part by Nivea for Men Replenishing Aftershave Balm for a shaving world gone mad.
Back at the campus of Indiana University in Bloomington, Dave Barnett, Bill Curry, and Heather Cox, 14-0 Michigan. They've had it twice. They have 128 total yards. Mike Hart has carried 11 for 55, including the second touchdown. And Indiana has had it a total of 3 plays. They went backwards 8 yards. The kick return by Jakeen Gilmore will end at the 30. And let's get another SportsCenter in-game update from Reese Davis.
Davis, Taco Bell studio update takes us to the Pac-10. Cal, one of those one-loss teams, never field a punt inside your own 10. Unless you're DeSean Jackson. That is 4th punt return for a touchdown this season. That's a Pac-10 record. And the 5th of his career. That's a Pac-10 record. He's a sophomore, guys. 7-3.
Yeah, Bill, he might be the exception. You let him back up occasionally inside the 10.
Let him back up in the end zone.
From the 31-yard line, Demetrius McCray has come in at tailback, and his carry brought down by Alan Branch. Nivea for Men starters now offensively for Indiana. Didn't get a chance on their very brief opening possession, but they feature a dangerous sophomore tailback in Marcus Thigpen. First Hoosier in 25 years to have scored on a rush, a reception, and a kick return in the same season. On second down, the throw incomplete over the middle, intended for Ray Fisher. And Lewis again looking at a third and long. Defensive coordinator Ron English in his 4th year on the staff, first as coordinator. How about this for an understatement? He says this year's been fun so far. Yeah, fun when you have the number one rush defense in the country. You're giving up 30 yards per game on the ground and 13 points per game. That should be fun.
Yeah, at 1.3 yards per carry against the rush. Indiana, according to Coach Heppner, was going to try to run it some. So far, nothing doing.
Don't look for it here either. 3rd and 11. And whistles before the blitzers can get to Lewis.
I can't tell you how happy Lewis is that those guys heard the whistle.
The layup game, offense, number 15. That's a 5-yard penalty, and it remains 3rd down.
Here's the group Michigan sends out there defensively. And up front, they are led by Woodley and Branch. David Harris, though, the leading tackler with 69, making his 22nd consecutive start. Coaches say a great leader. We could not ask for any more than what we get from Harris, a senior from Grand Rapids, who has made the semifinalist list for the Butkus Award, playing above what were already pretty high expectations. So on 3rd and even longer, the pass to midfield is incomplete, thrown out of bounds for Andrew Means. Morgan Trent and Jamar Adams have been doubled over there along the sideline.
You're going to get pressure from these guys because what they do, they've got a variety of fronts and stunts to do it, but they end up with one-on-one blocking, and most of the guys that they have rushing, starting with Woodley and going right through the lineup, cannot be blocked one-on-one. That time, Tim Jamison got there to make the hit, number 90.
Edie, nice job handling a high snap, and the wobbly kick, unreturnable for Steve Reston as it rolls out at the 31. So the dueling score is Ohio State now 20-0 up at Northwestern. Michigan will try to match that when they get it for the third time here with 3:18 to go in the first. Some of the pockets of Michigan fans here in Bloomington who have enjoyed the usual dominant performance by their defense. Indiana has yet to gain yardage on any of their first six plays from scrimmage. And this third Michigan possession starts at their 31. 3:06 to go in the first quarter. So they've outgained the Hoosiers 128 to -9 as this possession begins with a short gain by Hart and a tackle by Adam McClure. Going to visit with the third member of our crew, Heather Cox.
And sorry for the delay, guys. A little bit of audio trouble, but happy to be with you. Now, the big question coming into this game is, would Mario Manningham return to the form that he had with the team leading 9 touchdowns before he missed the majority of the last 4 games with torn cartilage in his knee? Well, guys, I think the early answer is yes. Already 2 catches. Now, offensive coordinator Mike DeBoard told me they'd use him just like they would before the injury, and more on him after this play.
And this is a 2nd-and-9 carry again by Hart, and again hit first by McClure, who is ranging all over the field. Heather.
Coach DeBoard said that Mario changes the complexion of the game. The teammates know he has big play potential, so the energy on the field is amplified the minute he steps into the huddle. And clearly the numbers don't lie. With him, the Wolverines have been averaging 33 points a game. Without him, just 22.
Yeah, that tells a pretty obvious story. 22 yards per catch. You go over to Breston, who's probably the better known of the wide receivers. He's been out there two years longer, but Breston averages less than 10 yards per catch, so they're completely different types of weapons for Chad Henne to go to. And without Manningham, Michigan not the threat to stretch you deep as they are with him back in the lineup. That throw intended for Mario and underthrown with coverage by Joe Kleinsmith. And at last, I think I can say this with some certainty, Michigan will punt. I thought they would before. They went for it and got a 4th-and-1 and continued on a touchdown drive, but 4th-and-4 here.
Well, that was just a poor throw by Henio that they would still have this drive alive. And you begin to get the sense of why Michigan is the number one team in the country in time of possession. They've had it like 9 minutes and 20 seconds to 2:33 for Indiana so far today.
Zoltan Mesko. Parents from Romania, father a former pro bowler. Sophomore from Twinsburg, Ohio. Kicking to Tracy Porter, who has it at the 24. Indiana's going to need something from their excellent return game today. So far, nothing. And Porter punctuates the end of that return by putting the ball on the back of Charles Stewart, but not drawing the flag. Now let's check in again with Reese Davis.
All right, Dave, Northwestern's had the ball 3-4 times against Ohio State, turned it over 3 times and punted. This, the latest turnover, the shade picked off by Brandon Mitchell right down the sideline for the touchdown. The Buckeyes rolling toward Michigan next week. It's already 21-0.
Or barring some unscheduled naps, so much for the trap theory today. The swing pass caught by Ray Fisher and the first positive yardage on any snap today by the Indiana offense.
And significant that it was done by Ray Fisher, significant in that he's from the same high school as Ted Ginn, coached by Ted Ginn Sr., and he's a true freshman, great speed, nice presence there to make that catch, and he looks like he may be the only one in the Indiana uniform that's not intimidated.
So they go from -9 to -4 total yards now in the final minute of the first quarter. And the first quarterback draw of the day from Kellen Lewis. Look for this maybe a half dozen times today. Lewis keeps for the first down up near the 40.
Lewis starting to look like himself here, asserting himself a little bit, running with some authority. He has not looked like the guy that I studied on tape the last couple of days. He hasn't thrown with the same assurance. The Indiana team has not played with the poise that they did in the games in which they played well earlier. Maybe they'll get untracked here.
Kellen Lewis is their leading rusher. Came in with 333 yards, and that pass intended for Gilmore is incomplete. The Indiana receivers can't afford any drops today. You really, especially with a 14-0 hole, you're really asking for perfection. You knew that coming in if you're Terry Heppner. You've spotted the number two team in the country 14 points. You can't have any drops.
No, and Kellen Lewis has got to throw the ball well. That was not a well-thrown ball. It still should have been caught by Gilmore. But the young guy is up against the number one defense he's seen, and it's taking its toll on everybody on this unit. You just hope they, if you're Indiana, you hope they get it together.
First give to Marcus Thigpen. Great speed, breaks a tackle, and is going to be close for the first down near midfield. Finally tackled by Morgan Trent, the corner. Thigpen, a state-ranked sprinter out of Detroit. But all Michigan in the first quarter in Memorial Stadium in Bloomington. The number two Wolverines lead Indiana 14-0. We're back in Bloomington. College football presented by Cars.com. On ESPN, Big Ten action, number two Michigan, making Lloyd Carr very happy through the first 15 minutes, leading 14-0, outgaining the Hoosiers 134-13. And on third and short, movement but no flag, and Josiah Sears, the third tailback, has the first down. So Indiana with a little offensive progress, and they had absolutely none of that in the first 15 minutes.
I guarantee you Ron English had them over there on the sideline, the Wolverine defense. I don't want them to make an inch. I don't want them to make this first down. I want you to get them stopped, and they darn near did it. He talks about practicing fast, physical, and execute every snap. They almost got the stop.
Actually, pretty quiet quarter for Lamar Woodley. They kept him as blocked as possible. And Indiana will call time here, discussing a first and 10 coming from midfield. So we'll return to Bloomington, 14-0 for the number two Wolverines.
Reese, Lou, and Mark with you in the studio, keeping an eye on Ohio State and Michigan. What have you seen so far that you like, Lou?
Well, I think about the University of Michigan. We know they're excellent on defense. But, boy, they run so well. I don't believe that Troy Smith's going to have the success scrambling this year like he has the past 2 years.
What's impressed me about Ohio State today is their defense. 3 turnovers forced, and they even scored on defense.
They had a pick six. They've been dominant on D. They're up 21-3, guys. We'll keep an eye on it.
All right, Reese, back here in Bloomington, 14-0, Michigan. As after the timeout, it's first down and 10. From midfield for the Hoosiers. And Lewis steps up, feels pressure. And finally throws in a diving grab by Ray Fisher. The best play yet for a struggling Indiana offense.
We understand what Terry Heppner means when he says this guy gives us a chance. Great job of being on the move, and that field awareness that we talked about at the top of the broadcast, Kellen Lewis brings at the tender age of redshirt freshmanhood.
To coin a term, I guess.
Sometimes they just pop out.
Deepest drive yet for the Hoosiers from the 39. And again, Lewis does well to get anywhere near the line of scrimmage. Well, part of this weekend's festivities included last night's induction into the Indiana Sports Hall of Fame of Dick Enberg, sportscasting legend and Indiana graduate.
Thank you.
At least 2 degrees. How many degrees do you have from this institution?
I have my master's and my doctorate from Indiana. My undergraduate school was Central Michigan. In fact, mixed emotions. My daughter graduated from Michigan last spring, and she's watching in Manhattan the telecast with all her Wolverine buddies today.
Second down and 11. Indiana continues to rely on the legs of Lewis. You got a doctorate in health and safety
here at Indiana, yes. And I taught and coached out on the West Coast at Cal State Northridge before Gene Autry decided that they needed somebody to do some sports casting. But it all started here. I did the first game ever in this stadium. And in 1957, well,
this is really what you're in the Hall of Fame for.
Well, I believe me, I'm not in for my athletic talent. I'm in because I talked a better game.
Greatest sports game show host ever, Sports Challenge. Welcome to Bob Feller.
Oh, man, all my heroes. You know, I've rubbed shoulders with greatness for 50 years, Dave. And it's so nice. You know, you really can come home to your university. And this is a beautiful campus and beautiful people, Bill, as you know.
They
are. Just to be able to refresh those memories. They're indelible and they're beautiful.
You did the first game ever in this press box, in this stadium?
In this stadium. When I started in 57, of course, the program has always been on the low counts. Remember Phil Dickens at Wyoming? He had the side saddle tee. That was their offense in 57 at the old stadium that no longer exists. My last year here was 61, and I did the dedication
game.
You
were broadcasting. You were only 11 years old.
it was the first voice. They formed a network when I was here. And I won the audition. I was the first announcer of the Indiana University Sports Network. Don Fisher, who's a very talented guy, has been doing it for about 30 years now, is the announcer. And, you know, we lived through a lot of long football seasons, but basketball always was refreshing.
And we should have been calling you Dr. Enberg all these years.
Well, you have a couple of honorary doctorates. Bill, you belong in that category.
No, I don't.
Academic All-America, I remember that in your collegiate days.
Of all the events you've done, we're talking Olympics, Super Bowls, Final Fours, everything. If you could relive one event, what would it be?
Well, I lectured a couple of nights ago at the journalism school, and they asked that question. I said, for every sportscaster, if I could give you one wish for one game, it would be to call a no-hit, no-run baseball game. There is nothing dramatically better than the buildup. You get that seventh inning, and they're all zeros, and every pitch, every movement means something.
Nolan Ryan, Angel,
no-hitters
in your case. Lewis on third and two. And going deep and intended for Thigpen in the corner of the end zone at incomplete. Dick Enberg, a pleasure and honor to be in your presence. Congratulations for your induction into the Hall of Fame this weekend.
Thanks, Dave. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you for coming.
Enjoy your stay at Indiana.
Thank you so much.
One of the legends of our business paying us a visit here. Dick Enberg, Indiana graduate, as Lewis challenged the double coverage here and trying to hit Thigpen.
Yeah, Lewis showing his youth from time to time, throwing the ball precisely where he should not have. That's when you come off that and you get rid of it or you run it up the field.
So down 14 to nothing, you go for it on fourth and two, and the grab is made for the first down to the 23-yard line.
Again, awareness between Hardy and Lewis. They've been working all summer together. They came back and had a good camp. We sat in their presence yesterday. You could feel the chemistry between them. Just a nice throw to the outside. He knew his big guy would come down with it. That quick release, an unusual-looking delivery and maybe a little bit low. Leon Hall on the coverage, so they went at the main man and made the first down. That's progress for this young offense.
First time those two connect today. And it keeps this possession going. Thigpen on the carry. Chris Graham comes up with the tackle for Michigan. Ohio State leading 21-3 now, as you see in the upper left corner of your screen. 5 minutes gone in the second quarter from Evanston. And Michigan finally forced to punt. That leads to this Indiana possession, which is now past the 4 minute and 52-yard mark. They had negative yardage on their first two possessions. From the shotgun, Kellen Lewis. And that throw over Ray Fisher and incomplete. Let's get another update from Reese Davis.
All right, guys, Miami and Maryland. This is the longest touchdown pass in Maryland history and the longest touchdown pass Miami's ever allowed. Sam Hollenbach to Darius Hayward Bay, hooking up for 96 yards. This after they'd hooked up on a 65-yard touchdown play. 14-0 turfed up.
Boy, any resemblance between this year's Miami and any other Miami you can think of continues to be just coincidental. Hit early by two big plays at Maryland. Lewis gunning and almost a diving interception on a ball intended for Gilmore.
Jamar Adams on the coverage. And what you see from this Michigan defense is one of those deals you would swear there must be 14 of them out there, Dave, with white shirts on. There are too many of them. They're getting pressure. It looks like there's two people covering everybody, and that's where you come back to the bench. And finally, the offensive coordinator says there can't be double coverage on everybody, but that's how it looked. You can't block Woodley. You can't get past two guys down there around the receiver. It's just a great, fast, well-coordinated defense.
Austin Starr, 9 for 11. This is a 39-yard effort. And Starr has this one through. Indiana is on the board with 11 and a half minutes to go in the first half. A near interception by Jamar Adams. And Indiana takes advantage, and they trail 14-3. Quick kickoff by Indiana, returned by Steve Breston from Michigan up to the 26-yard line. And the Wolverines now leading by 11, 14-3, take over from there. Terry Heppner finally got something going offensively, and I think maybe even more important than getting the points, Bill, was the confidence, because the Indiana offense had zero
far more. They didn't look like the same team we had seen move the ball against other good defenses. They finally awakened, and they're starting to play.
Hart going back to work for Michigan and storms his way for about a dozen. Mike Hart headed toward a 100-yard first half, 14 carries for 73 already, and one of the two Michigan touchdowns. The junior from Syracuse following behind the blocking of Jake Long, the rest of the Michigan offensive line. And when called for, they'll get the fullback, Obi Olibo, in. He cleared some space out on a couple of short yardage possessions. Tyler Recker, the tight end, in motion as Henny has time to set up and fire deep for Breston. And Breston brings it in over the shoulder and has a touchdown, 62 yards. First touchdown of the year for the senior Steve Breston.
Football is a game all about mismatches in today's football. You get a free safety like Will Myers, manned up on a guy like Breston, and he simply doesn't have the same foot speed. In this case, in his efforts to stay with him, he trips and falls. Breston careless with the football there. Sometimes there's some unpleasant surprises, Steve, when you do that, buddy.
Garrett Rivas, 21-3 in both Evanston and Bloomington. Chad Henne could not have had an easier time. There wasn't a pass rusher within 10 yards of him.
No, great protection, beautiful throw. Breston with his first touchdown of the year. But you better put that thing away, because sometimes people chase you down and knock it out of your hand when you least suspect it. And the bunch that he plays next week has the kind of speed to do that.
Breston and Nick Davis of Wisconsin, the only two players in Big Ten history, 1,000 career yards in three categories: receptions, punt returns, kick returns. So it's odd to look up in game 11 and see that that is his first touchdown catch of the year. Yeah, he almost pulled a Leon Lett. I think Dick Enberg called that Super Bowl where Leon Lett got chased down from behind.
That's exactly what I was thinking about. Now, that I know Steve doesn't run like Leon, but you just don't take that chance. You put it away, you get it in the end zone, and make sure you get the touchdown.
So Michigan has shown that they can sustain drives and pound it away, and they strike quickly here. Just a couple of plays, all they needed to make it 21-3. The kick bobbled by Gilmore finally finds the handle, but it costs him on the return. Tonight, 7 Eastern, ESPN2 from the Southeastern Conference, as Tennessee tries to knock off the only SEC team to make it this far without a conference loss, visiting number 11 Arkansas. College football primetime on ESPN2 Saturday. Available in high definition as the number 13 Volunteers try to sneak out a win in Fayetteville. And to do so, they're going to have to control one of the best running backs in the country, in McFadden. Houston not making a change at quarterback. Casey Dick starting. Mitch Mustaine, the freshman, will come off the bench. Demetrius McCray wiped out on the screen pass by David Harrison. Let's get a Reese Davis up there.
All right, Dave, one SEC team with one loss has already fallen today in Auburn, and Florida off to a slow start against South Carolina. Mike Davis getting in for the Gamecocks. Trying to remember who's coaching South Carolina these days. Oh, yeah, Steve Spurrier with a 7-0 lead in his old stomping grounds. It's still early in the second quarter there. Nebraska, 2-touchdown lead on A&M. Virginia Tech's up by a field goal in Kent State.
What a surprising early 21-7 deficit for Texas A&M. They had Oklahoma at home last week, lost that one by one. Nebraska today, and then they close Thanksgiving Friday at Austin against Texas. Third and long coming for Kellen Lewis near the shadow of his own goalpost and trailing 21-3 in the middle of the second quarter.
That last drive, it was just a matter of seconds with the deep ball, is the one thing that Terry Heppner said his team simply could not get away with if they were going to stay close in this game. This is the other third and long, and there's Mr. Woodley.
Lewis throwing off his back foot and incomplete as he tossed that one up for James Hardy to try and pull down. Not a bad idea. He is 6'7", but he was covered by the best they have back there in Leon Hall.
Chris Graham pressuring the quarterback and forcing this ball to be thrown earlier than it should have been. And the timing is completely thrown off by the ferocious pass rush and the marvelous coverage, mostly man coverage. We talked to that defensive coordinator, Ron English, and he said Hall can cover anybody.
Low line drive kick for Beating. Rolls out right at midfield. And just 33 yards into the wind that time for Tyson Beattie. And let's check in with Heather Cox.
Dave, certainly not the start the Indiana defense wanted after giving up 378 passing yards and four TDs to Minnesota. They worked all week on shoring up their pass defense. They focused on different assignments instead of making personnel changes. Indiana spent the week simplifying its coverage and simplifying its reads and really trying to avoid having its DBs on an island. But Coach Curry, do you think they've done that so far?
No. No, Heather, they're struggling.
They're having no success stopping this Michigan offensive line surge. And Hart just picks a white jersey to follow. He's going to get 5, 6, 7 yards minimum every time before finally Greg Brown, in this case, makes the first contact.
Well, the point that Heather makes is very valid. What you do when you have a bad day, and of course Indiana had a terrible day at Minnesota. Minnesota Cupido had a marvelous day, but you simplify and you make sure you don't have busts. So they haven't been busts. You've just been individuals getting beat in coverage.
Hart now at 79 yards as he is replaced by Brandon Miner. And Miner likewise keeps that surge going. It is just across the 40. We're to be third and less than one. Miner, the freshman from Richmond, Virginia, Michigan's second leading rusher. Last week had his first 100-yard game, 108 on just 12 carries with a touchdown against Ball State. He has had to sit out 7 games this year with a hip flexor. But they're going to have him healthy in time for the 1-2 matchup, which is on target as we see Ohio State now taking a 27-3 lead at Northwestern. Just a couple of minutes ahead of our game, and it is short by a couple of feet.
What we're seeing virtually every running play now, Dave, and this is getting more and more pronounced. We'll get a good look at it here. Look at the surge. That's what's called zone blocking. Look at the white shirts just surging, moving, keeping their feet. You got defensive linemen that are 6 and 7 yards down the field. They're just getting knocked back. Keith Burris, for instance, 7 yards back. He thinks he's fighting his blocker. That blocker's got his pads down, his feet churning, his knees bent. Here's another good look. Zone blocking, referring to the fact that everybody just takes a zone step to his left and continues to move and knocks anything in its way back.
Hart back in to dot the I, and follow the block of Olipo as fullback. This is close, and I don't think he gets the first down here. I'm not sure he gains an inch.
Good job by Keith Burris that time. He was embarrassed. Somebody must have said, hey, they're up there talking about you getting knocked back. So he made the first hit, and McClurg came in to clean up. We got unofficially McClurg with six tackles here in the game. Nice job by the big guy there. That's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to fight back. They knock you back, you knock them back. And that's what Indiana's got to do. They've got to get their pads down and get tougher.
Lloyd Carr's already converted one fourth and one. That was in his own end of the field. No question he's going to try it here. Look at the hole for Hart. And he gets about 3 or 4 yards after contact. And on fourth and one, he picks up a good seven before the safety, Will Myers, finally makes the tackle. So another Michigan possession is extended. Well, Wake Forest has surprised everybody this season. They're currently co-leaders in the Atlantic Division in the ACC. Tonight, they visit perennial conference power Florida State on ABC. Others will see Texas try to keep their BCS title hopes alive as they visit Kansas State. Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines. ABC, 8 Eastern tonight. College football lives here. Brandon Miner chased down for, I think, what may be the first loss turned in by the Indiana defense today. Greg Middleton with the hit on Miner.
Indiana really high on Greg Middleton. Now, here's a true freshman. Here's a guy that was playing high school ball in Indianapolis a year ago. He's got enough talent. He beats the blocker. He comes clean in the backfield. Nice job. Good job in the backfield by Big Middleton.
Miner with a loss of two, replaced by Jerome Jackson. Henny with the fake to him. And Chad has to step up into some pressure, and he is brought down for his first sack at the 37 by Greg Brown. An update from Reese.
Dave, Ohio State promised they would not look ahead to Michigan. It might be safe to do so now. Troy Smith for the second time today finding Brian Hartline. The Buckeyes all over Northwestern 27-3 in the second quarter.
Well, this game has paralleled that game score for score pretty much throughout this first half. We'll see if Michigan stalls here as they look at a third and 13. Hart back in at tailback. They keep him in the block. Henny with time and delivers complete. Tyler Ecker, the tight end, is inside the 15-yard line, a gain of 22 on just his fourth catch of the season.
Ecker, who didn't even start the game, he has been a starter in prior games. The protection allows for the big fella to come three deep position and has.
And a big return. Leslie Majors out near the 30. Majors turns in the kind of play Indiana has to have to hang with Michigan. And they turn away a Wolverine scoring opportunity. Majors with the pick and a return of 30 yards. Indiana ball, 3:10 to go in the half.
College football brought to you by John Hancock. The future is yours. And Singular, raising the bar.
Back in Bloomington on a drizzly, gray, breezy 40-degree afternoon. 21-3. Terry Heppner sees a key takeaway on the Leslie Majors interception and the return out to the 30-yard line. A return, by the way, ended by the man who threw it, Chad Henne.
Sort of.
And plenty of time. Well,
sort of.
Much as he could.
Sort of a tackle.
Plenty of time for the Hoosiers to make it more interesting as Lewis goes back to work and he starts with a completion to James Bailey. Here's today's game track presented by John Hancock. First touchdown of the three for the Wolverines on that short fade to Adrian Arrington. Hart with 17 carries for 86 yards and a touchdown, and 62 yards on the perfect toss from Henny to Breston. Indiana answering with a 39-yard field goal by Austin Starr, 21-3 inside the final 3 minutes now of the first half. And another short toss for Bailey. Out of bounds at the 45 with an Indiana first down.
Chad Henne would love to have this throw back. Watch the corner at the top of your screen. That's Leslie Majors. He's a floater. There's nobody threatening his zone, so he's coming from left to right as Henne sees it. Henny's reading from right to left. He never sees him and throws the ball right between the 2 and the 8, and Majors says, thank you so much.
First real mistake for Chad Henne today.
Why is this man smiling?
Is that a smile or a wince? Maybe a grimace. Here comes the blitz. And Lewis, feeling it, turns and throws for Ray Fisher. No, he caught it out of bounds. Incomplete.
Yeah, and he had run out of bounds and come back in. This guy's going to be something special. You can see it. The true freshman from Glenville, Ohio. The Ted Ginn coached, Ted Ginn Sr., that is, the Ted Ginn coached young man really has some ability, and you can just see what's going to happen in the future for this Indiana receiver core with their young quarterback. Nice attempt there to get something done with this swarming Michigan defense.
Yeah, the feet are inbounds here, but as you pointed out, they were already out of bounds.
His whole foot didn't even get down there, but it was very close. You can see the athletic ability he has, and they also say he's the fastest guy on the team.
So second down and 10 with 2:43 in the half. And again, the Wolverines with the blitz. The deep throw will draw a flag intended for Hardy.
Good call. Yes, indeed. And here's what happens. Lewis gives you a chance in the game for so many reasons, and I'm using Terry Heppner's words now. He gives us a chance because he can run out of trouble. He can break contain.
Pass interference.
Here's the call.
Defense number 21, 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
The reason that was called on Ryan Mundy is because he had his body between Hardy and the football, and he has to give Hardy a chance. He can't be shoving Hardy. In the view of the official, that right elbow comes out, and he's forcing the receiver away from where the football is thrown, and so you get the 15-yard penalty. Now, Indiana got a little something to work with, a little confidence.
Plenty of time and one timeout left. Looking right, throwing back left to Bailey, and that's been the featured play on this possession. Lewis with the short toss to James Bailey. And let's get an update in the studio from Reese Davis.
All right, Dave, coming up on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, Mark May and Lou Holtz will join me. The Buckeyes are showing why they are ranked number one in the nation, just as Michigan is proving why they're deserving of number two. We'll tell you why it could be a devastating day for the national title hopefuls in the SEC and Steve Spurrier's homecoming when we come back.
Well, sticking with what works, Lewis again throwing complete to Bailey, and Bailey's going to have a first down just inside the 30 against the coverage of Leon Hall.
Now, there's some cliches that became cliches because they are true. We asked Hardy yesterday, do you think you're going to be allowed to have single coverage very much? He just laughed and said, not a chance. So what's happening is Indiana's taking advantage of the fact that there's single coverage on James Bailey, and they're just throwing one hitch after another, and that's the best offense they've shown.
Hardy, the inside receiver right this time on the quarterback draw. There is room to roam up the middle, and Lewis spins down to the 16 with another Hoosier first down, a gain of 13.
This guy's a special player. Again, field awareness of where the tacklers are, making the first down, and you don't see him sliding, and I think in his maturing process, he'll have to learn to get on the ground and not take all those shots. For now, he's just a football player. He's going to be a great one.
And their leading rusher on the season coming in. To the back corner of the end zone, a jump ball for Hardy and incomplete as they test the best cornerback there, Leon Hall.
Number 29, Leon Hall on the cover.
Terry Heppner, the second-year Indiana head coach, on his talented redshirt freshman quarterback.
He gives us a chance with his, he's our leading rusher, and sometimes it's because we call plays by design for him to run. Partly is, oh, hold your breath. He just took off again. Look out. Something's, as Bobby Bowden would say, something's fixing to happen.
Well, Bill, Indiana has 33 yards rushing. It's because of Lewis, and that's more than Michigan gives up per game, although he gives it away here, throws it right to Morgan Trent, and so much for the Indiana scoring opportunity. Mercy.
Well, we bragged on him and bragged on him, and he deserves every bit of it, but it is true that this is his first year, and sometimes the ball just gets away from him. And it's hard to overthrow Hardy at 6'7", and Hardy had a shot at this, but here we go. Hardy is the big guy that's the third man in at the top of your screen, or to the right of your screen. He's got the throw. He's got the touchdown if he just hits him. Instead, he goes over. Morgan Trent picks it off.
Boy, the legs of Lewis help set that chance up, and the arm of Lewis ends the opportunity. Terry Heppner living with the talent, but also the inexperience of his redshirt freshman quarterback, Kellen Lewis, who gets Indiana the scoring chance and then gives it up with a badly overthrown pass.
Well, he reminds me of Antoine Randall L. in this same uniform, in this same stadium, at the same stage of development. And Antoine made some mistakes, too, in that early going. But this guy's going to be really, really good, and I'm sure the Indiana coaches hope that he's as good as Randall L. I can tell you this, he makes the same kind of impression with his intelligence and his awareness.
A little bit bigger than Antoine Randall L. He's got probably at least a couple inches on him. Lewis listed at 6 feet. Antoine in the boots wouldn't approach that. Hart not able to turn the corner or stop the clock as he's brought down by Leslie Majors.
Antoine in boots.
In high heel boots. In platforms.
You never cease to amaze me, Mr. Barnett. You find a way to paint a vivid picture. Yeah, but Randall L., I just think, is one of the most exciting football players ever. And I think this guy's got the same kind of potential.
Well, we used to watch him here as a quarterback, wondering if he'd get a chance in the NFL. And not only did he get a chance, he turned it into a very lucrative career. So Lloyd Carr and Michigan will head to the locker room halfway to an 11-0 record, taking care of business so far, up 21-3, as we join Reese Davis for our Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
An 18-point lead in Bloomington. Michigan avoided that collision in Columbus. Coming up next week. And number two, Lou Holtz and Mark May alongside. And while Michigan's taking care of business, Ohio State, which got a bit of a scare last week against Illinois, in the state of Illinois, making sure they aren't scared at all this time. Tressel and the Buckeyes against Northwestern. Troy Smith, Ryan Hartline.
Wonderful job of protection for Troy Smith, but what a pass by Hartline. And right here, just plowing it right in there, finding the legs. The Antonio Pittman bounces it to the outside and takes it in for the score.
He's over 1,000 yards for the season. And then Brandon Mitchell.
Well, they have
the end zone for Northwestern, 27-10. They're just about to go to halftime on ABC. The Buckeyes appear to be out of danger as far as the upset before they meet Michigan next week. But not every team out of the woods as far as the upset bids go. Auburn thought its case among the one-loss teams was strong. A day of frustration on the Plains, who that might benefit if they can take care of a business against a legend.
The Pontiac Performance Halftime Report is powered by Pontiac. Vote for this week's Pontiac game-changing performance. Go to ESPN.com, keyword Pontiac. Welcome back to the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
Michigan defense has been stifling again. The Michigan offense has been effective. 21-3, number two Wolverines have the lead over Indiana. The team next on their schedule, Ohio State, against Northwestern. We showed you it was 27-10 just before the half. See, Mayday, they were so worried about Brian Hartline, they let Ted Ginn run free.
And Ted Ginn, what a great job of coming down with a reception, but holding on to it and taking away from the defender. Nice job. Ted Ginn, Troy Smith, good combination.
Yeah, you know, I use the term running free a little loosely there, but I'm sure they were double covering Hartline, who has two touchdown catches today. Hey, you know what? Ohio State has botched two extra points in this game, 33-10 at the half, but we're splitting hairs at this point. Number five Auburn at home against Georgia. The Dogs have been hapless. They lost 4 out of 5, barely survived against Mississippi State to avoid a 5-game losing streak. But all of a sudden, the Dogs were hunkering down. Craig Lumpkin from 8 yards out, and Trey Battle. I think Trey Battle wants a helmet sticker on College Football Final tonight.
Not only once, I think he earned and deserves it with 3 picks today. Trey Battle takes this one all the way to the house for 30 yards for the score.
37-15, Georgia hammers Auburn. South Carolina and Florida. Whip. Hey, I got a couple ball plays. You know, I used to call some ball plays down here. I won the Heisman Trophy with a 40-yard field goal against Auburn. South Carolina and Florida, Chris Leak looks for the shovel pass. Jasper Brinkley there led to a missed field goal. Florida's 2 out of 9 in field goals this year. Mike Davis powering in, Lou.
Just a very fine effort here. It was a very sustained drive all the way down. Nothing fluky about it. They just beat Florida up front.
And then moments ago, Chris Leak, just before halftime, a little throwback. Fred Bennett's got that well covered, but not when you're dealing with Dallas Baker.
The touchdown maker.
7-7, Gamecocks and Gators at the break. Cal and Arizona. DeSean Jackson has 3 punt returns for touchdowns this year. Don't ever field the ball inside your own 10-yard line on a punt. Can I get an amendment to that rule, please, for DeSean Jackson?
It would be nice if he made it look hard. He makes them all look so easy.
That's a single-season record in the Pac-10 with 4 punt returns for a touchdown. Also a career record for the sophomore, who now has 5. And in case you don't enjoy DeSean Jackson, wait, there's more. Nate Long short of DeSean Jackson.
He should be a Biletnikoff finalist. He's been outstanding the entire season long, but it's always a big play with DeSean Jackson. It's great.
He already is a Biletnikoff semifinalist, taking it to the house there. Notre Dame rolling over Air Force. Brady Quinn trying to bolster that Heisman resume, Lou.
I'll tell you, 8 for 850 yards, 3 TDs in about 25 minutes of play. That is Heisman candidate numbers, Mayday.
It's Air Force, Lou.
Air Force. Who almost beat Tennessee, I might point out.
27-3. I love to take the stick and just jab it. Cincinnati at West Virginia. Here goes Pat White. Who says he can't throw? And look at this grab by Brandon Miles, Mark.
Oh, talking about body control. Not only 1 foot, he gets both of them in there. That's an NFL type reception. Nice job.
14-3, and then Slayton showing the wheels, Lou.
Oh, I tell you what, this guy is so quick, he could turn out the light and get in bed before it gets dark. Just look at him run away from people. He had great vision, tremendous runner outside.
42-24, West Virginia over Cincinnati. When we come back on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, some things that we've never seen from Maryland nor from Miami in their showdown in the Snake Pit.
You're watching the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report.
Miami and Maryland, the Hurricanes playing while grieving after the shooting death of Brian Patter earlier this week, wearing the number 95 in his Maryland Miami scoreless in the first quarter. That's Sam Holland. Nothing. And those two were. Hayward. Touchdown pass in Maryland history, and the longest touchdown pass the Hurricanes have ever allowed. 14-0 way into the ACC championship game. Kirby Freeman getting the start. Kyle Ryan has been banged up a little bit, finding Ryan Moore. 14-10 at the half right now. The Terrapins have the lead over the Hurricanes. In the ACC Atlantic, Wake and Maryland, surprisingly the only teams with 1 loss in conference play. Wake Forest in Tallahassee to take on Florida State tonight. Maryland and Wake still have to play each other. Maryland still has a date with Boston College too, Mayday.
And both those coaches, if you look at Ralph Frisian and Jim Grobe, outstanding coaching jobs this year when it was supposed to be an off year for both of these programs.
On the other side of the ACC in the Coastal, all Georgia Tech needed was 1 more win to book a trip to Jacksonville for the title game. Deshard Choice for the the Jackets.
Okay, highlight over. Done.
If you like offense, that's it. Georgia Tech, under 30 seconds to go. North Carolina has a great opportunity. Joe Daly, ill-advised. This has been a bugger this year all season for Bunting's teams. He throws the Jackets get a sack, and they hang on. They are going to the ACC for Chan Gailey's team. Play, but this is Retief Goosen.
Hello.
Back at Memorial Stadium in Bloomington, Indiana, college football presented by Cars.com and Chad Henne in Michigan on top 21-3. The only chance this game had to become interesting was right before the half, and Kellen Lewis threw an interception to Morgan Trent in the end zone. That preceded by Henne's only interception of the first half, and he threw it at the goal line to Leslie Majors. So that exchange at the end of the second quarter, keeping it an 18-point Wolverine advantage.
Well, there are a couple of ways to define interesting. It got interesting in the second quarter because Indiana had 7 first downs to only 4 for Michigan. The time of possession was almost dead even, with Indiana having the edge in the second quarter, 747 to 713, when in the first quarter it was something like 11 to 4 in favor of Michigan. So Indiana settled down and got over its intimidation factor and is at least playing better.
And they're going to get the ball to begin the second half. Barry Rivas's kick. Returned from the 8 by Marcus Thigpen, one of the best in the country. He breaks this one up near midfield. He has 3 touchdown returns to lead the nation. The first Hoosier with more than 1 in a season. And that one comes back 38.
Man, he's fun to watch. This is well blocked. Properly caught right in the middle of his body, and that's the way kick returners are supposed to catch the football. Look at his agility and speed. Nice job. No fear. Hit the holes that he had, and they start at the 45.
Figured today they'd need something from him, maybe a touchdown return. They might need their defense to score, and they could not afford mistakes, certainly not an interception in the end zone the way they ended the first half. They start the second with Demetrius McCray unable to outrun the defensive end, Lamar Woodley. And Heather Cox spoke with the coaches at halftime. Heather?
Indeed, and I asked Coach Heppner if he was pleased with the fact that they already have 3 more rushing yards in this game than Michigan allows in an entire game. He said, no, absolutely not. Points are the only thing that matter. We have to eliminate the mistakes. Michigan really makes you pay. Now, as far as Lloyd Carr goes, I asked about his philosophy of playing his starters throughout the second half, and he does. He said he will do whatever it takes to win. He thinks they've defended the deep pass well. Then I asked if he knew about the Ohio State score or if he wanted to. He said no.
Here's a short toss for James Hardy. He's close to the first down. Lloyd somehow is aware of the Ohio State score.
Lloyd's a real good friend of mine, and he doesn't lie very often. But if he had a straight face when he said that to Heather, Heather, you need to ask him that again. Of course, I wouldn't go over there right now.
Yeah, that was your chance.
You're talking about an intense competitor. Of course, all these guys, they wouldn't be Big Ten head coaches. They all want to win so much, and they're so smart.
Catch by Hardy just short of the first down, and a flag flies. We haven't had many of those. As McCray's again brought down by Woodley.
McCray, the ball carrier. There is a flag.
Holding Indiana. Each team only 1 penalty in the first half.
During the run, holding, offense number 74. It's a 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. It remains third down.
Well, it's the bane of an offensive lineman's existence that the only time you get your name noticed, that's Chris Mangiero, who's a senior, and he just, whoops, oh, Chris, they're not going to, you can't do that, son. That was a hog-tied takedown. That was a necktie takedown. He had a hold of Terrence Taylor, and Terrence could make you do that. He's a heck of a nose guard, 300 pounds packed into a 6-foot body.
And Gerald, one of 21 departing seniors in their final home game at Memorial Stadium today. Lewis chased into a sack. David Harris, the middle linebacker.
And we talked a lot about Ron English today, the defensive coordinator for Michigan. He's made some changes. He took over from a longtime great coordinator named Dave Herman, who went on to the NFL. But he has a lot of different looks, and that's David Harris, the middle linebacker, who's up in there hitting the A-gap, and he's in the backfield in a heartbeat. A lot of new looks for Michigan, tough to protect.
Tyson Beatty. Wind at his back, easily his best kick, resting back at his 18. First Hoosier missed, and now it's trouble. Beatty, the only man back, no chance of stopping Preston. Touchdown, Michigan. 82 yards.
15, Preston on the kick return. Touchdown, Wolverine.
He has broken a four-way tie for the Michigan career record. That is the fourth touchdown return of the career for Steve Breston.
I'd like to say that was well blocked, but that just wouldn't be the truth. Two tacklers were on him immediately. Both ducked their heads and dove rather than wrapping him up. That could have been a three-yard return as easily as it was an 80.
Revis adds another extra point.
Kick is good.
Talk about mixed emotions. Beatty gets off his best kick, a 47-yarder, and then he finds himself on the island charged with stopping Breston. Couldn't do it. 82-yard return, 28-3. Can't have a much bigger day than Steve Breston so far. He has a 62-yard touchdown catch and an 82-yard touchdown on a punt return. Fourth return touchdown of his career.
Well, it had to be
set tie, and he has the record by himself now.
I guarantee you he was taking a little heat from the guys in the locker room. I mean, when you're going to score a touchdown, Steve, you got 45 catches, you must be slow. So he doesn't have to hear that anymore.
Problems mounting for Indiana. Thigpen bobbles that kick and returns it only to the 12-yard line.
But this is actually well covered. Both Tracy Porter, who's coming down from the top of the screen, and James Bailey at the bottom. Here's Bailey. Now, this is going to be cut back inside, and he's got a perfect shot, and all he's got to do is keep his head up, drive his head across, and make the tackle. Instead, he ducks his head, dives at the ball carrier. No good ball carrier goes down with that kind of tackle. So the coverage was good. You just got to finish the play.
So backed up at his 12, now down 28-3. Lewis, the Indiana offense back to work, and Michigan defensively teeing off. David Harris nails Marcus Thigpen.
Like I said, this defense is intimidating. This is the most intimidating defense I've seen this year. This is what I mean. Look at that. You've got somebody at your feet, so you can't really get your pads down and explode. And your Thigpen, you hit it up in there with all 190 pounds, and you get drilled. David Harris with 240 running as fast as you do.
Another loss. It took a couple of Indiana possessions and all but 1 minute of the first quarter for them to gain on any play. Thigpen almost bent backwards as he again runs into Harris, trying to get back to the original line of scrimmage.
David Harris showing NFL scouts exactly what they want to see. Can this guy explode and shut down an offense between the tackles? The answer is absolutely. Now, you could say, well, there's no blocker on him, but his acceleration, the quality of his angles, and his sense for where the football is going to be shows that he's got a future. We're going to watch this guy play a long time, number 45, Harris.
Leading tackler for the number one rush defense in the country, allowing 1.3 yards per carry, 30 yards per game. They're at 26 right now, minus 7 in the second half. Nowhere for Gilmore to go, and Jakeen finally runs out of room of the 14.
I have not seen a group of linebackers that run like these Michigan linebackers, with one exception, and that's the bunch from Ohio State a year ago, A.J. Hawk, Carpenter, and that group. Could run about like this, and they, of course, were the dominant defense in the country.
And they were supposed to be irreplaceable, or
yeah, they
so
got a
some
bunch,
thought.
They got a bunch now that run almost like that.
He Edey got off a 47-yarder last time. Stands at his own one, and that's the only way to make sure Breston doesn't do any damage to you. Out of bounds with 9:41 to go in the third quarter. Henny and the Wolverines back to work after a 43-yard kick, leading 28-3.
ESPN's College Football, brought to you by the Principal Financial and Taco Bell. Think outside the bun.
Bloomington Courthouse on one of the more picturesque town squares you'll find here in the Midwest. 28-3 Michigan. Dave Barnett, Bill Kerr, and Heather Cox. The Wolverines in position to move to 11-0. Ohio State, as we continue to track their score at Northwestern, also up in dominating fashion, 33-10 with just 3 minutes gone in that second half. Wolverines back to work now to take over with great field position and hard carries brought down by Keith Burris. All right, you have matched up position by position, number two Michigan and number one Ohio State, starting with a quarterback. You give the edge there, obviously, to the Heisman favorite, Troy Smith.
Well, just remember when you saw those two beautiful girls back in high school, the one you saw most recently looked the best to you. Well, I've seen these two teams in the last few weeks because I was there for the Ohio State Indiana game.
Brandon Miner on that carry. Yes, continue with your beautiful girl analogy.
And so the one you've seen most recently looks a lot better than the other one. And then you see the other one and you think, gee, I don't know, maybe this one looks better. So Ohio State looks so dominant that day. Michigan's looks so dominant this day. And yet I am forced to make these decisions. But I need some help from Heather. Let's talk to Heather.
Well, a little bit of an update on Ohio State quarterback Troy Smith. He's playing today with a sore right thumb. He said he wouldn't use the injury as an excuse for subpar performance last week, but he did admit that the injury happened quite a while ago, but it continues to get worse and worse as the season goes on.
Here's a third and three, and Henny on play action, drilled as he lets it go for Preston. And his big day continues with a first down to the 29. 23 yards.
Yeah, I saw Henny in the Ohio State-Michigan game last year because I was there. Here's Preston again, just having an outstanding. This is what he does best. He's an inside receiver, usually lines up in a slot position, and he finds open spaces. Henny knows he's going to take the shot there. Geno Jackson clean again. He steps up, delivers the football. I'm very impressed with Henny today.
He's 10 out of 14 for 164, two touchdowns, one interception. Jerome Jackson with a flag down. Jackson, one of three tailbacks Michigan has rotated in. Keith Burris makes the tackle. Illegal motion, Indiana.
Illegal motion, offense number 13. That's a 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. It remains first down.
Greg Matthews, an outstanding true freshman prospect, had a lot of speed from Orlando, Florida. There you see Breston with his day, three receptions, 103 yards. That's not a bad average, 34.3.
That includes a 62-yard touchdown, so 5-yard mark off, first and 15 Wolverines. Jackson again trying the right side. And into the secondary, chased down again by Burris, the defensive tackle. All right, so quarterback, slight edge, it sounds like, for Troy
Smith.
Yeah, wide receivers, come on, pick a group. You can't check both groups of wide receivers.
I checked both groups. I think it's a dead heat. Two great groups of wide receivers. We've seen Preston emerge today. Running backs, I think Ohio State's got a little bit more explosive group of running backs. O-line, D-line, linebackers, I mean, what Michigan has done today is just show me that they've got a slight edge in those areas, and I think that'll win the game. DBs, special teams, Ohio State has the advantage for sure.
Jackson right up the middle, first down to the 17. And you like Michigan, and did I hear you say by a field goal in overtime?
By a field goal in OT. I think it's going to be a game for the ages. I love both the teams. I think they're extremely well coached. I think they're disciplined. They're tough as nails. I think it'll be a great football game. I would pay to get a chance to be at the 50-yard line.
Well, it's amazing that as long as they were the big two in the Big Ten, as long as it was Woody against Bo, they never squared off 1-2 in the country. You had to figure there were a lot of years where they had a chance to be undefeated when they played each other to end the season. But this would be the first time. Jackson with a great cutback and near a touchdown. He's finally caught at the one by Geno Johnson, a gain of 17.
And Jake Long, the big, fine offensive tackle, who's a co-captain and of whom Lloyd Carr speaks so glowingly, just sealed that hole, did a good athletic move. He didn't just knock somebody back that time, but showed his footwork. There's Jake. Got some incredible tattoo work there. I'd love to know what that means. But, man, can he play football? And Lloyd Carr speaks more glowingly of him than any other player I've ever heard him talk about.
Jerome Jackson continues on for the touchdown on a drive that mostly featured him on the ground. He has his second touchdown of the year. Out of Saginaw, former Michigan High School Player of the Year, came off his best game of the season, 6 carries for 68 yards against Ball State. And he earns some serious second half playing time here today, and he makes it 34-3, 5:37 to go third quarter. The Michigan route continues. Garrett Revis just banging that one off the upright, and he misses his second point after the year. So 34-3 it remains after the Jerome Jackson touchdown. Michigan on track for that meeting with number one Ohio State next week. Jerome Jackson, number 24, the senior from Saginaw, has put Michigan up 34-3 with 5:37 to go in the third quarter. ESPN College Football presented by Cars.com from Memorial Stadium in Bloomington. Terry Heppner, the second-year Indiana head coach, has seen his offense put together just 86 total yards so far, 26 on the ground. They've lost 7 here in the second half. Michigan with a couple of touchdowns. And now this return by Thigpen as he searches and does not find any room around the corner. Today's game track presented by John Hancock. Reston with over 100 yards on 3 catches. That includes a 62-yard touchdown catch. This an 82-yard punt return for the first score of the third quarter. And Jerome Jackson just posting the second. Hoosiers start from their own 19. Lewis through the air, 10 for 22, 60 yards and an interception. On a ball that had a chance to make it, 21-10 just before the half. Intercepted in the end zone. Demetrius McCray for a short game. Well, we look back at some of the legendary meetings between Ohio State and Michigan. In 1969, it looked like Woody Hayes and Ohio State would repeat their national title from 68, but Garvey Crawford for Michigan, one of his 2 touchdowns on the day. Second quarter, Michigan's Barry Pearson with a 60-yard Steve Breston imitation. That set up another Wolverine score. And Michigan pulled off the upset 24-12, and the Bo Schembechler era had its first signature moment. Lewis through the air, and a stretching grab at the 16-yard line made by Andrew Means. Down to Heather Cox.
Well, speaking of Bo Schembechler, 3 weeks ago, he fell ill while taping his weekly television show. He was rushed to the hospital, where he underwent a procedure in which a device that combines a pacemaker with a defibrillator was implanted into his chest. Unfortunately, this wasn't the first time he'd had 2 prior heart attacks and 2 quadruple heart bypass operations. The good news, the legendary coach is progressing well, watching the game from home today.
Half happy with what he's watching.
No doubt.
Lewis on the keep. He has been the sum total of the Indiana running game. He was their leading rusher for the season coming in, and he's got a first down with a yard to spare. John Hancock game track now with the Preston punt return, his school record fourth return of his career for a touchdown. And that followed shortly by Jerome Jackson's one-yard scoring run. Revis with the extra point hit in the left upright, keeping it 34-3. First down, scrambling. Lewis. Demetrius McCray to the 35. David Harris chasing the ball from sideline to sideline as Michigan's leading tackler on the year.
45, Dave Harris is on the stop.
I think we just broke a record, Dave. This is the longest screen pass on record for a plain drop back screen to a back. And David Harris once again showing all of us, everybody in America, hey, I can run with these backs. Not only can I fill tackle to tackle, I can get to the sideline if necessary.
Lewis now 7 of his last 10 through the air. 12 of 24 for 70 yards for the day. And Berry back inside the 30, fumbles, but Indiana gets alignment on the recovery. Tim Jamison supplying the pressure. And recovered by Kyle Thomas, the left tackle.
Another good example of what Michigan can do as they stunt. Jamison lined up over here to the right. If we can stop it right here. Jamison came from way over here to the right. He was lined up outside your screen, outside the viewing area. He loops up inside a linebacker blitz, and it's almost impossible to block, especially with the kind of speed this team has.
That turns into another third and long, third down and 9. Lewis for Hardy has had a fairly quiet day. That should be enough for another first down, just to the 41. Another David Harris tackle. It doesn't matter who has the ball. It can be somebody else's wide out. He's not necessarily probably supposed to be covering, but he'll still make his way over, make the tackle somehow.
Well, I spent a lot of time talking about this magic between Kellen Lewis and James Hardy. What Michigan defense has done, Ron English has just schemed them out of their magic by bracketing and double covering Hardy most of the day. So he hadn't been very active.
Hardy has come in with 19 career touchdown catches in just 18 games. Lewis has had a couple of decent quarterback draws, almost fumbles this one away. Let's get an update from Reese Davis.
All right, Dave, you probably saw the score up in the corner of your screen. Ohio State now at 40. Here's how they did it. Troy Smith, his fourth touchdown pass of the day. This one to Anthony Gonzalez, 40-10. The only thing the Buckeyes have done wrong, they botched a couple of extra points.
Well, and so has Michigan today. That's the kind of thing that coaches would lose some sleep over the week before a game like this, I think.
Oh, coaches invent things to lose sleep over before games like this. I mean, of course, there's never been a game like this in the Big Ten.
Lewis on second down and 9, and not looking for that pass was Ray Fisher. But he finally did turn around. He looked over his left shoulder, and Lewis threw it over his right.
Willis Behringer, number 19, getting the start at free safety today. The veteran just sees a nice touchdown coming, and he fails to do one thing. Look at the tip of the ball and catch it. Willis, catch the ball, and you run for the touchdown. Nice break on the ball by the veteran free safety.
And another third and long. Last time they picked it up with Lewis hitting Hardy. Hardy 4 catches for 30 yards today. Any defense would be happy holding him to 4 for 30. This is James Bailey, quickly wrapped up by Leon Hall. The NFL scouts who come through Ann Arbor, they'll say, may have the best cover skills of any quarterback they've scouted this year in the country.
Yeah, he's a 4-year starter, and when you're at a program like Michigan, it's almost impossible to be a 4-year starter because very, very seldom does anybody get a chance to play as a true freshman, especially out there at the corner position. But that's what happened, and Hall's just gotten better every year.
Beatty drops back, and Michigan calls time with a minute 4 to go in the third quarter. expecting the punt when we return to Bloomington. 34-3 Wolverines.
Tap the can, ladies, for a single if you can.
Fans in Indiana finding something worth dancing about. Probably just the cold weather. Might as well dance, keep warm. Michigan fans hopping up and down in this chill. It's got to be somewhere in the 30s, and the wind has been a factor all day, and it continues to pick up left to right. It rained earlier today, but we've stayed dry for our entire contest here at Memorial Stadium. So Beattie, after the Michigan timeout, gets a Preston fair catch. He bobbles and hangs on to the 12. All right, so we showed you one of the memorable Ohio State-Michigan games from 69. 4 years later, Ohio State number one, Michigan number four, fourth in inches, Dennis Franklin to tie it at 10. Soon after, Greg Hare intercepted by Tom Drake of the Wolverines. That drive stalls. Mike Lantry from 44 yards out wide right, and it ended 10-10. And I would think up until this year, that was probably the premier Michigan-Ohio State game. Next Saturday, first time since 1935 for a conference to have two teams 10-0 or better. Michigan leads the all-time series. 9 prior matchups, both teams ranked in the top 5, and Ohio State 5-3-1 in those games. But again, they have never played as the top 2 teams in the country. As Jerome Jackson stays in and breaks another long one. Brought down by Troy Grossfield. Not before a gain of 16. Both Ohio State and Michigan heading full steam ahead toward that battle in Columbus next week.
Just talking about all the precedent-setting things that you're bringing up, Dave, all of which is fact. But one thing that those teams in the past did not have was the kind of media scrutiny that these guys do. These guys are going to be interviewed as if it were the Super Bowl. I mean, I don't know how they're going to get to class or take care of their regular business. And the team that can face those distractions and get ready will be the team that will be the best prepared.
Well, both coaches have national championships. Lloyd Carr in 97, Jim Tressel in 02. One of them may add to their collection on the mantle before this year's done.
Power up.
This telecast available on ESPN HD, presented by Pioneer Plasma. And we're back at Memorial Stadium in Bloomington. Dave Barnett, Bill Curry, and Heather Cox. ESPN College Football presented by Cars.com and Lloyd Carr. And the Wolverines having their way 34-3 as we begin the fourth quarter. They have allowed only 114 total yards. 326, almost perfectly balanced for the Wolverines. 162 on the ground, 164 through the air. Jerome Jackson continues to give Mike Hart the second half off at tailback. Let's get a Reese Davis update from the studio.
Dave, yet another one-loss team being challenged. Cal in Arizona. Cal is up 17-3 when Chris Henry plows into the end zone to make it a one-touchdown game. And remember, Arizona's won its last 3 November games against ranked teams.
At some point, Mike Stoops has got to get it going. This may be the week out there in Tucson.
Well, I know he would be very happy if that were the case. When you try to get those things going, sometimes you feel like you're birthing quintuplets and you can't quite get to the next one.
Second down, 11. Brandon Minard takes the handoff, followed by fake reverse.
46, Jake Powers makes it stop.
But while they were faking that reverse, which is supposed to give Ohio State something to think about, Beal comes off the center, number 54. And what we want to show you is a reference to what Mike DeBoer, the offensive coordinator that has rejoined Michigan after a previous stint, went over, became head coach at Central Michigan, now back as offensive coordinator, has gone to a zone scheme in large measure because Mark Beal has the ability to reach what we call nose guard one techniques. And when we get a chance to show you that again, we will.
Henny sacked on third and long by Kenny Kendall. That's his team leading fourth sack of the year.
And when you're Lloyd Carr in Michigan and you're getting ready to play the Buckeyes next week, this is not what you want to see late in the game. You put in a substitute. You put Corey Zibel in there, let him play Zibel to play left tackle. You drop back to pass, and your star quarterback gets ear hole from the blind side. Not a good shot.
The only senior defensive lineman in the two deep for the Hoosiers, Kenny Kendall, comes away with that sack. And the punt by Mesko, returned with a flag down by Tracy Porter. We'll see if this return will stand. If it does, Indiana is in tremendous field position after a 37-yard punt comes back 24 yards.
Yep, Terry's upset, and he should be. It's going to be JT Owens, number 24, with a push in the back, I'm afraid.
Disregard the flag. There's no foul on the play.
Well, then JT Owens' body language when he got up and displayed dismay that, hey, I didn't do it, was correct. How often do you see that? Good for you, JT.
They actually believed him. Indiana sets up on the Wolverine 37-yard line. And trailing 34-3, clock rolls 12:40 to go. They have, again, just 28 yards on the ground against the nation's number one rush defense, which gives up 30 per game. Lewis again chased and forced into the throwaway. So, playing out the scenario, Ohio State, Michigan, one of those teams will have a loss. There's speculation that if it's a close game, then the public sentiment will be behind a rematch in the national championship game in the Cardinals' new stadium in Glendale, Arizona. But there's also going to be public sentiment for a one-loss team to get a shot in that game. And there's a chance that it could be a Texas-Michigan rematch of the Rose Bowl from 2 years ago or a Texas-Ohio State rematch from the game won 24-7 by the Buckeyes in Austin this year. Demetrius McCray finally gets a little bit of room around the corner and is knocked out of the 32 by Johnny Sears. Well, Texas still has some business to take care of to keep that scenario alive. They're part of Saturday Night Football on ABC tonight, along with number 18 Wake Forest at Florida State. At 8 Eastern, Texas visits Kansas State. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines on ABC. 8 tonight, college football lives here. Texas still has Wildcats tonight and Texas A&M the day after Thanksgiving in Austin. And then the Big 12 championship. There's business to be taken care of there. In and out of the hands of James Bailey. They're a one-loss team that can state a case. There are a number of others, though. And as we look again at the incompletion, that's going to make this discussion, I think, completely different than last year when it was obvious that USC and Texas were the 1-2 matchup that we wanted to see and we would get a chance to see. That may not be nearly as clean a picture this year. Hoosiers go for it on 4th down and 5. And in a 3-receiver set, Lewis with time, and the ball is bobbled and dropped by Andrew Means in Michigan holds.
Well, you're exactly right on all counts, Dave, about the one-loss thing. And I'm standing here listening to you, and I'm wondering what's going on with Florida and South Carolina. At last word, Florida seemed like they might be in a little trouble.
Any trouble Michigan might have had bobbled away here. But
Reese Davis, Lou Holtz, and Mark May with you on ABC. Ohio State's taking care of business just as Michigan is. They're going to meet number one versus number two for the first time. What's going to be different when we see next Saturday, Mark?
Troy Smith will be running the football in his two games against Michigan. He's averaged 91 yards a game, and he's had 2 rushing touchdowns. Watch for Troy Smith to run the football against the Wolverines.
But what the Wolverines have to continue to do is play great defense. And by that, I mean this. They average 3.5 sacks per football game, and in addition to that, 8 lost yardage played. Let me tell you, it's difficult to get a first down when you lose lost yardage.
All right, Justin Zwick, you saw a moment ago in the Ohio State game warming up. I want to make sure Troy's ready, guys.
All right, Reese, and back here in Bloomington, you were just wondering about South Carolina, Florida, Bill, and the Gamecocks just take a 10-7 lead in Gainesville. And Michigan with a 34-3 lead to protect here early in the fourth quarter. They continue to get backup running backs on the field. This is freshman Carlos Brown with his first carry from Franklin, Georgia. So that's a one-loss team, Florida, trailing at home. One-loss Auburn, beaten badly at home by Georgia today.
Yep,
so,
yep. So it's not a one-loss team.
Two teams falling out of the one-loss category and maybe clearing the way for one of the remaining one-loss teams, like Texas, as we discovered. Arkansas is part of that group, but they have Tennessee tonight on ESPN. And again, the carry by Brown, first down. Today's game track presented by John Hancock. Four sacks and a key interception in the end zone at the end of the first half when Indiana had a chance to make it 21-10. Interception turned in by Morgan Trent. And Jerome Jackson resting Mike Hart to the tune of 8 carries, 65 yards, and a touchdown. Hart has 92 yards on 19 carries, and he also has a score. Three straight carries for Carlos Brown. No gain here. Wolverines welcome back fully into the game plan today. Mario Manningham, he was on the field against Ball State last week, but it was really just kind of to get him back in uniform. And coming off knee surgery, there was no thought that he might play a big role last week, but that wasn't the case today. Indiana, on the other hand, Bill, has kept him under wraps pretty well, just two catches for 11.
Yeah, but I don't think his number's been called much. I don't think you risk a Manningham in a game like this when you're when it's already put away. I think it's been by design that Michigan hadn't used him much. I really do. We will see him have it aired out to him next week, I promise you.
Brown meets the surge by Geno Johnson, sophomore strong side linebacker.
Yeah, I really thought after Henny took that blind side in the last series that we probably wouldn't see any more of him. I just think, and Lloyd Carr is a great football coach, and he's got a thing about keeping his regulars sort of in tune, even though they've got a blowout, and keeping them motivated, keeping them in the game. But there is a risk involved.
Here's a third and 11 for Henny. Haven't had to go to the air much today. This swing pass will go backwards on the catch by Elijah Bradley. Bradley with his first reception, first touch, in fact, all year, and just the second catch of his career for a converted former running back from Richmond, California. A senior gets in here in the fourth quarter.
Nice tackle there by Will Patterson, a true freshman from Indianapolis, playing that buck position, the Will linebacker, and Terry Heppen with a lot of good, young, fast skill on this football team.
Ross Ryan on the field to punt for the first time today. Very high effort, and coming up for the fair catch is Tracy Porter. 32 yards on the punt. This is what these two have done today. Ohio State's put 47 on the board at Northwestern. But the margins are about the same, rushing about the same, total yardage is about the same.
You see this kind of thing again and again. I just sat down with the stats today, the Big Ten stats and the national stats, and between Ohio State and Michigan, the similarities are really incredible. They're so closely aligned in terms of what they've accomplished statistically.
Kellen Lewis, as he has been all day, chased out of the pocket before he throws complete on the run to James Hardy. And Hardy has a gain of 12. Let's check in with Heather Cox.
Well, I heard Coach Curry earlier say that you'd pay to go to the game, the Ohio State-Michigan game. Well, I did a little research for you. Tickets are available online, but, Coach, it's going to cost you. The cheapest ticket I could find was $220. That's for upper nosebleed end zone seats. The best ticket, $4,500. You'll get one ticket on the 50-yard line. What's it worth to you, Coach Curry?
Did you get me one, Heather?
I love it, but not that much, Coach.
You could afford it.
Baby needs new shoes.
That's a sorry excuse.
Lewis is sacked back at the 34. Fifth sack of the day for the Wolverines, the first for Will Johnson. Boy, $4,500. That will test your fanhood. Are you that much into Ohio State or Michigan? No doubt somebody will be.
Dave, I don't have to tell you. We get a shot here of Will Johnson, who's a backup defensive lineman. Their backup defensive lineman run faster than most people's starters. Nice job there by Will, but there are a lot of people that'll pay that $4,500 in a heartbeat to be at that game.
Second down, 18. As Lewis throws complete over the middle for Ray Fisher. Let me put you in the mind of both coaches. First of all, Jim Tressel, what would keep him awake this week worrying about Michigan? And there's a lot of things. What mostly do you think he's
doing? You know what? I mean this now. I'm around Jim Tressel every now and then. We got to do one game last year and one game this year. Actually, it was against Indiana. We'll let this play run, and then I'll complete my thought.
And there's the countdown, by the way. 6 days, 21 hours and change. Before kickoff in Columbus, ball batted away, incomplete, defended by Charles Stewart.
Let me tell you what Jim Tressel said. And one of the people in our group asked him when we had the interview with the coach, well, coach, this is such a big job. There's so much pressure. I mean, well, how do you deal with all that? He said, well, my dad was the coach at Baldwin Wallace. I thought that was a great, great job. I was the coach at Youngstown State, and I love that. I love this job. They're all the same to me. I get the feeling that Tressel has got things in perspective, and he handles it very well.
Punt by Tyson Beattie. At the 25-yard line. 37 yards on the kick. Michigan fans sticking this one out. They're enjoying a 31-point lead.
ESPN's College Football is presented by Cars.com. Find the right car for you, Cars.com. And in part by Cooper Tires. Don't give up a thing.
Back in Bloomington, Dave Barnett, Bill Curry, Heather Cox. 6:05 to play in Michigan, still on top 34-3. Chad Henne's day is done. He finishes 11 of 15 for 158 yards, two touchdowns and one interception. And his backup, sophomore Jason Forcier out of San Diego, checks in. And Elijah Bradley with the ball. All right, so you think if anybody can handle the buildup and the pressure and everything goes with this matchup between Ohio State and Michigan, Jim Tressel's pretty well suited to that. What about Lloyd Carr? What would keep him awake this week?
Well, I think he's got a good handle on it, too. I don't see him all nervous and shaky, and the way you see some coaches uptight, sometimes he might get a little abrupt at some dumb questions we ask, but we all have done that.
Forcier now 3 for 3 on the year, and the ball fumbled by Carson Butler, but Michigan comes up with the loose ball and the recovery of Terrell Savoy. Now, what kept John Cooper up after this 96 matchup? He brought an undefeated Ohio State looking like a national champion. Brian Greasy, though, hitting Ty Streets, who took the short pass a long way for the only Wolverine touchdown. Their defense did the job and upset the number one Buckeyes 13-9. That Ohio State team went on to beat Arizona State in the Rose Bowl. That might still be the most talented college team, that 95-96 Ohio State team I ever remember watching. Orlando Pace, Eddie George previous year, Terry Glenn, all those folks, and that Michigan team probably, as they look back after winning the national title the next year, could say, well, that push toward the 97 championship probably began by denying Ohio State the 96 national championship.
You could argue that Brian Greasy got his start there. He was starting here.
Absolutely.
He had not played much, and he had been redshirted. And I think there was a question as to whether he could really take them all the way. And then the next year, he just built on it. He got better and better and did a great job for them. They went the distance.
So Second down and 10. Brandon Miner. A loss, and let's hear from Reese Davis in the studio.
Dave, a tough day for one-loss teams and fights everywhere. Cal up 17-10 on Arizona, and there goes Chris Henry again. The junior tying the game at 17 early in the fourth, and Florida made a field goal finally. They tied South Carolina in the fourth at the Swamp.
Well, a memorable return to the Swamp for Steve Spurrier so far. In a 10-10 tie. Final 3:20 here in Bloomington. This is a third and 11 roll for Zieg, playing in his fifth game of the year. He looks, has room, keeps, blasted at midfield by Jake Powers, but I think he's got a first down. He's got 11 yards.
Yeah, now Forcier is a big old guy at 6'2", 220, and I like his acceleration here. He breaks contain. Somebody was supposed to keep him in contain over there, did not do so, and he tucks it away. He actually shows some presence, puts the ball against his chest, which is what you're supposed to do, and runs until he's knocked down by Powers. Nice job. Henny enjoying the toque he's got on over there to keep his little head warm.
Michigan continuing to run the clock down. Another carry by Carlos Brown. I want to thank the sports information staffs from both schools, Jeff Kegg and his group from Indiana, Dave Abloff from Michigan. We also want to say hi to Bruce Motti, our friend who has long run the sports information operation at Michigan. He lost his father, William, this week. William passing away at age 87. So our thoughts and prayers with Bruce Motti and his family, one of our good friends on the college football scene. Down to the final 2 minutes in Bloomington. Michigan winning its 15th straight in the series, its 30th in the last 31 meetings with Indiana. Brown is going to be close for another first. And today's player of the game, presented by Cooper Tires, did it on offense and on special teams, Steve Breston. 231 total yards, three catches for 103 and a 62-yard touchdown, and a return to punt 82 yards for a school record fourth career touchdown return.
I got to say that Breston's been about as effective a player as I can think of that has stayed underneath the radar. He's the best player you hadn't heard much about in the last 4 years. He's had a great career.
Timeout called here. Stops the clock at 1:28.
I'd just like to add for Bruce Motti, what a wonderful man, and how his hospitality through the years has been so great. We always look forward to being with Bruce, and I share Dave's concern, and Bruce, our hearts and prayers with you all the way.
What is Lloyd Carr, what's the point he's making here with the timeout at this point in a route?
What he sees in a route is he sees people starting to lose concentration. And you run around out there, you don't do things properly, and you get a little bit sloppy, and that's when people get hurt. And he's saying, you guys have got to learn to finish a job the way I want you to. I mean, that's what hurt them last week against Ball State. They didn't finish the job the way he wanted. So that's the point. I'm guessing that that's what he's saying.
Michigan defense led by David Harris turning in another monumental performance. They've held Indiana to 129 total yards, 25 on the ground, minus 8 on the ground in the second half. Mostly because of quarterback draws and keepers by Kellen Lewis. Indiana at the half was over what Michigan allowed per game, 33 yards on the ground. They lead the nation giving up 30 per game, and they're 25. And Lewis through the air, 104 yards on 16 of 33 with an interception.
Yeah, and I think the most dominating stat I've seen this year in college football is 1.3 yards per carry. The Michigan defense for the season, that's almost impossible when you consider spread offenses and the way everybody's running the ball out of the spread. It's just tough to do that even if you have a great defense.
That means everybody they've played, they have made one-dimensional. As Miner gets down to the 25 with a first down.
Now, one other eccentricity about NCAA statistics that we have to mention in order to be responsible here, sacks are deducted from rushing yardage, and that's another reason that Michigan has that outstanding number. If you didn't deduct sacks from the rushing yardage, it wouldn't be quite as impressive, but it's even with that, it's a darn good job.
Yeah, they'd have 60 rushing yards if they hadn't been sacked
times. That's right.
Five times for minus 35. But that's part of the formula, has been for them all year. Minor with a cutback. And that should put the cap on Michigan's 11th win in as many games this year. Ohio State takes care of its end of the bargain, too, leading 47-10 at Northwestern in the fourth quarter. So the stage is set for history in Columbus next week. It will be number one, 11-0, Ohio State, and number two, 11-0, Michigan. They knock off Indiana 34-3.
But another great coaching job by Lloyd Carr this entire year, answering his critics coming off a tough year with a great.
This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Bill Curry, Heather Cox, our entire ESPN crew, I'm Dave Barnett. Good night from Bloomington, Indiana. Let's send you back to our college football studios and rejoin Reese Davis. Michigan, very impressive again today.
Coming up on Michigan Replay, the Wolverines stay perfect with a road win over Indiana. We'll see the highlights. We'll also meet Obi Alibo, a Nigerian nightmare for Michigan opponents. And we'll look ahead to next week's showdown of showdowns. We'll scout Ohio State. All that and more coming up next. Michigan Replay with Lloyd Carr is brought to you in part by Diet Mountain Dew. How Dew does diet. By Pontiac, official performance machines of Michigan and the NCAA. By Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade, is it in you? By LaSalle Bank, proud to support the University of Michigan football program. LaSalle Bank, making more possible. And by Big Boy Restaurants. Oh boy, Big Boy, celebrating 70 years as your hometown family restaurant.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Michigan Replay. Well, the Wolverines got past Indiana 34-3 and set up the showdown of next week. Now, everybody wants to talk about next week, but we can't just yet. We still have to talk.
We could if we wanted to,
yeah. But if we did, everybody in the control room would get mad.
So well, we don't want that.
And we don't want that. Although, I don't know. You know, it's kind of fun to see them go off the handle. Here's the deal. Indiana was a game you were concerned with. They had a mobile quarterback, and your team really responded, I think, the way you wanted them to, especially in the first quarter.
Well, we came out, Jim, we did a great job of mixing the run and the pass. Our defense got us the ball back. We got two very good drives to start the game, and you're right, that's exactly the way you want to play on the road.
And people really realized Indiana came to this game with on an emotional level. They really wanted to get after Michigan because of Coach Heppner and his remarks and some of the things that went on. And you had to match their intensity early, and I thought you did.
Well, they had a lot to play for. They still do. They're one game from being bowl eligible. Terry's done a great job there. And as you mentioned, this Lewis is an elusive guy. Guys, a lot of skill. And I was most worried about their return game, the punt and kickoff. So, you know, it was a big challenge for our special teams as well.
We go to the highlights. This is your first possession, and you couldn't ask for a better first possession in this football game.
I run the bootleg pass, and you know, Chad sees that they don't have anybody in the strong side flat, so he gets the ball out to Steve. Here, Mike Hart makes a Mike Hart type of run, you know.
It's like one of those, how does he do it?
He bounces outside, defines a cutback, and makes a positive out of a negative.
And then here Mike goes again. This is with a lead draw, and he just, again, makes people miss.
Well, I thought we mixed the run and the pass very well. We had some good play action passes here on the 1 yard line. A well thrown football to Adrian Arrington. And now we're off to the start we wanted to be on.
Just 4.5 minutes into the game and you've really taken the crowd out. Then defensively, this is key, keeping this guy under control.
Well, I thought, you know, he got out a couple of times, but for the most part, our defense contained him, and when he did get outside, we had people chasing him. And, so I thought we were very effective.
Got good field position. You go for it here on 4th and 1 on your side of the 50, and you got it.
Well, Jim, on the road, you know, you hate to punt the football, and we had confidence that we could make a yard, and Mike Hart did that, the people up front.
How about Jerome Jackson coming in to spell Mike Hart? He's really come on of late, hasn't he?
Well, I think he's gained everybody's confidence, and of course, he's a guy that's always has confidence in himself. And here, Chad makes an excellent throw to Adrian Arrington for a big first down to keeps the drive alive.
Then Mike Hart goes in, good block from Alibu, and Mike Hart goes in, and it's 14-0 after two possessions. Just the way you wanted to start it.
Well, it is. And, you know, we came out with good intensity. We didn't have the penalties today that we had a week ago. Here is one of the plays that gets out of there. We let the ball outside. We miss a tackle in the backfield. But he's an elusive guy. And we did. Thank goodness that was about the only time he got out of us.
You go to the second quarter, and this is, again, the quarterback making a good play on the run. Keeps the drive alive, and this is their only scoring drive.
Well, the good news there is that we did lose contain, but we had the quarterback running away from the line of scrimmage. He made a good throw on a fourth down play. He hits Hardy, the guy 6'7", but that was good coverage by Leon Hall.
You hold him to a field goal. It's 14-3 at this point. Then. Big play, City, and what an unbelievable Saturday Steve Breston had.
Well, you know, here we get very good protection. Chad can step up and find Breston deep for a touchdown. And, you know, big plays really demoralize a defensive team, a team period. And it was good to see Steve get open deep. And, of course, it was a team effort there, good protection. Chad made a nice throw.
Defense continues to play hard. I tell you what, David Harris was everywhere on that field.
David Harris has been everywhere all fall, Jim. And, of course, that's a play that you've got to diagnose. And if you don't, it's a big play. But David found a way to get out and make the tackle on the screen.
You're up 21-3 and still pounding the ball with just under 5 minutes to go in the second half. And it looks like you're going to put more on the board here.
Well, this is a big play in the game. It's also a big play because Tyler Ecker's been out 5 or 6 weeks. And he's a big target, and it was great to get him back in there and back playing. Here, Chad makes, really, he was 11 for 15. It's his only bad decision of the day. And they got good field position, and with 3 minutes to go, they got time.
And they're moving the ball down the field. They use these little passes to kind of get out of bounds, keep the clock stopped, and move the ball down the field.
Well, we're playing a lot of zone coverage, and he's dumping the ball in front of us, and here they come back with a quarterback draw. We ducked our head there and missed a tackle, but got him down, and then we've got another play to play and come up with good coverage down there, and he makes an overthrow. We get the interception. I think that was a big turning point in the game.
Really was a big turning point because you go off in halftime leading 21-3. Were you feeling good? I mean, you had to be feeling good about the game, but the interception and their drive kind of bothered you head a little bit going into the second half, didn't it?
Well, I thought we had really played well in the kicking game. Our coverage teams did an excellent job. The only play that bothered me is that we turned the football over because we're in field goal range. It was a third down and long. We had had trouble getting the drive going. But we gave up a scoring opportunity. That's the only thing, because I thought defensively we'd played very well.
The Wolverines did play well in the second half. They played well, too, and they put it away 34-3. We'll be back and see those highlights. But first, we hear from Jerome Jackson talking about offensive balance is really by design.
We practice on that all week to have a great balance plan coming into this game, and that's what we did. We went out and executed the run game, the pass game, and we had fun out there today, so we got the job done.
Michigan Replay and Al Rose Steel take you inside the locker room.
We did our job, like I said. We had fun out there. You know what I'm saying? Getting pressure on the quarterback and let the back end do their job.
Tim Jamison, a great kid, Lloyd is just saying. And he had a great day, a big smile, wonderful personality.
Well, you know, he's one of those guys that has fun playing the game, and I think he helps everybody else have fun because he's just a guy that has great enthusiasm.
Talk to me about the second half now. As you go in, what was your message to the team taking the field with the 21-3 lead?
Well, we were playing well. We had control of the game. We needed to take the game out of their hands in the third quarter, and we decided to kick the ball to Indiana, and our defense came up with a good stop to start the third quarter.
They did indeed, and again, this is where good things happen. You stop them, they kick it to Steve Breston, and this is the highlight of his day, and it was already a huge day.
Well, Rondell Biggs, in that previous job, did a great job containing. We had pressure up the middle. And right here, we talked all week about getting Steve loose, and our return team there did a great job.
And that makes it a 28-3 ball game. And boy, now you've got it under control. You can start playing some other players. But the one thing is, the defense continues to start playing. This is David Harris, is one of his best plays.
Well, David Harris, as we talked earlier, I think anybody's followed Michigan football this fall. David has had just an outstanding season, and having his best season as a fifth-year senior.
Here's a great play by Henny. Under duress, sticks it right in there to Breston for a big gain on third down.
Well, they get a linebacker free, and I'll tell you, Chad Henney's going to stand in there until the last minute. He's not distracted. He's tough, and makes a big play on third down to keep the drive alive. And here's Jerome Jackson again running over the left side.
And here, he just runs through a safety.
Well, he gets his pads down and doesn't get knocked backwards there. If you're too high, and that's some of the problems that young backs have, they stay too high, they don't score that touchdown.
Got some kids in there now, and the defense never lets up.
Well, Brandon Graham has really developed into a guy that's a freshman that has really helped our defense and contributed a lot here in the latter part of the season.
Here's Jason Forcier at quarterback.
Well, at every opportunity you get, we fumble the football there, and we get a heads-up play by Latero Savoy, who recovers a fumble.
And how about this, a running quarterback at Michigan?
Well, it's been a while, huh? No. Greasy and Navarre and Brady, they wouldn't like me saying that.
That's right.
But Jason did a nice job there, Jim. That was a run-pass option. They dropped off in coverage. He ran for a first down, keeps the drive alive. Now we get another young guy in there, a guy that didn't get a chance to play as much this year, Carlos Brown. And then another number four in there.
It's not Brandon Miner. That's nope. Actually Darnell Hood, right?
Darnell Hood came here as a freshman.
Now tell the story about Darnell Hood and Fred Jackson.
Well, out of Bishop Gallagher High School, he was a tailback, and we moved him to cornerback, and he wanted to move. But earlier in this season, he came to Fred Jackson and our great backfield coach. He says, Coach, just get me one carry this season. So I didn't know anything about it
didn't
until
you?
Last week. And, of course, last week we didn't get a chance to get him in. So
did
this
you know
week
in,
we did.
In the game Saturday that he was in there?
Well, yeah, because Fred had told me before the game, he said, yeah. Lloyd, you know, Darnell, I promised him I'd try to get him in there. So he got two carries in there today and looked pretty good.
And let's not forget, that, you know, Darnell has been an outstanding special teams player his whole career, right?
Well, he's been a great team guy. He's going to get his degree. He's been successful here, and he's going to be successful when he leaves here.
Okay, that's 11 wins in a row. Let's wrap that up. Indiana, it's over now, right? Can we now talk about what's coming up?
Well, I think we've always talked about what's coming up. You know, you never, during the week, every season, or every, during the week of every season, you're always looking forward to this game. You're always doing some things to help prepare. So now, publicly, we've not talked a lot about it, but it's always there in front of you.
Well, believe me, this week, you're going to hear a lot about it because it's going to be all over the nation, number one versus number two. We'll get to those Ohio State Buckeyes in just a minute. But first, we're going to meet Obi Olebo. Now we hear from David Harris, who says how you deal with a running quarterback.
We just came out with a game plan of stopping the scrambling quarterback. He's a great athlete. And when we had our chances, we let him outside a couple of plays. But as a defense, we played our game and limited them in what they wanted to do.
One of the more quiet members of Michigan's offensive ground attack is fullback Obi Olebo. He's one of the key guys in clearing the way for Mike Hart in the running game. Obi came to Michigan with his heart set on playing linebacker, though. But Coach Carr thought fullback was a better fit. For Obi, that was a tough switch to make.
When Coach Carr wanted to move me to fullback, I was, and it was like somebody punched me in my gut and took all the air out. It was like, you know, I was on a high cloud and he brought me down. But making the switch, I mean, I love making the switch. It got me on the field quicker. I'm playing, helping the team win games, and at the end of the day, I'm still hitting people, and that's what I love to do, is go out there and just hit people. One thing I can say is I think I'm a fighter. I'm persistent, you know. I don't think it was going my way early on in my career, and I just knew that if I just keep fighting, that it'll work out in my favor one day, and I think it's paying dividends right now.
Olebo is of Nigerian descent and grew up in Washington, D.C. While he's never visited Nigeria, he still has family there, and they're very proud of him, even if they aren't completely sure what American football is all about.
Some of my family members in Nigeria have seen some of the games, maybe on the TV, they say have seen me before. And I don't know, maybe my grandma might understand it a little bit, but I'm not sure. I have to ask my mom if she understands it fully. And my mom always tells them, always gives them an update about how I'm doing and, you know, what school I'm at and the football I'm playing. And they're just proud of me. They might not fully understand what I'm doing, but as long as it's good and I'm out of trouble, they love it.
Obi clearly loves it too. He's a big part of an excellent team and he loves everything about Michigan. His love affair started the minute he stepped on campus for his first visit.
The environment is different. I'm from D.C. and I'm just more urban. I just like the rural environment about everything and just the family atmosphere around the football team and just the academics, everything about Michigan. It was a new experience for me, so I liked everything about it. Stood out.
Well, everything about Obi Olebo has stood out, hasn't it? He's just a solid guy.
You know, that move to fullback, he fought, he didn't like it, he wasn't happy. And I think in the transition there, I've come to really admire him. I love that kid. Comes from a great family, Episcopal High School in Washington, D.C. His father came in with a visit, and there was no doubt his father knew Michigan. He knew the academics, and that's really what sold him. And Obi Olebo is going to leave here as being an outstanding football player. I think he has a chance to play in the future.
I'll tell you what, he is a great blocking fullback, and somebody on Sundays may have him playing for him. When we come back, we'll scout those Buckeyes. We'll talk about it, okay? But first, we hear from Steve Breston. Just how big is next week, Steve?
Everything's out there for us, and what it comes down to is just a one-game season right now. You know, we play all these games just to have a one-game season. And, you know, we have a great opponent in front of us, so, I mean, you can't ask for nothing better.
You've seen how they play.
You cross that white line, it's all.
Now see how they live.
It's all mine.
Ron Williams. Visit attblueroom.com/sports for exclusive access into your favorite players' worlds.
In these shark-infested waters, a team of scientists and one brave volunteer are about to find the answer to an important question. Is Diet Mountain Dew as much of a thrill as regular Dew? results were clear. Diet Mountain Dew is all the dew with none of the calories.
You've seen how they play.
I just want to score on you one time.
Now see how they live. Visit attblueroom.com/sports for exclusive access into your favorite players' worlds.
The Pontiac G6 Series offers more combinations of options and accessories than there are drivers in America. G6 sedan, coupe, or hardtop convertible. Choose a shape, then build yours at Pontiac.com. Now, introducing the GM 100,000-mile powertrain warranty, plus courtesy transportation and roadside assistance on every 2007 vehicle we make.
We're big and rich!
99.5 WYCD's holiday concert featuring Big and Rich, the Coming to Your City Tour. Look out, it's party time.
Get ready for the hottest debut country act on the planet.
Saturday, December 16th, Palace of Auburn Hills. Big and Rich, featuring Cowboy Troy, Josh Grayson, and more. Get your tickets now. 99.5 WYCD's holiday concert to benefit Children's Miracle Network in Beaumont Hospitals. Presented by the Detroit area Chevy dealers.
Michigan Replay and Al Rose Steel take you inside the locker room.
We got to go out there and play our best game, and we got to practice. We got to get better this week, and that's our goal.
Well, clearly it's going to be a great football game. Michigan versus Ohio State. The entire country has been waiting for this one. The countdown started
six weeks ago.
They
look forward to it every year, but there is some extra things. Of course, the Big Ten championship and on the line, and that's what's gotten lost in this whole thing, isn't it?
Yeah. It's all this national championship stuff and stuff. This is for the Big Ten title.
Well, it is, and a chance to win the national championship.
There you go.
So there's enough riding on it, Jim.
Well, when you look at this Ohio State team, this guy for 2 years in a row has caused you problems, Troy Smith.
Well, he certainly has, and he's surrounded by a lot of outstanding football players.
Running back Antonio Pittman, they can still run the football, averaging nearly 5 yards a carry.
Well, this guy's an excellent player, a guy that runs hard, very physical, and a guy that does a lot of things for him besides just carry the ball.
And two receivers, really, I think, that are their go-to guys. Ted Ginn Jr., big play guy. But this Anthony Gonzalez, in my judgment anyway, is an unbelievable playmaker.
Well, he's certainly had an unbelievable season. He's stepped in and stepped up. I mean, a year ago he played an important role, and that has increased this year. But defensively, that's where they've replaced nine starters, and they're statistically, I think, a better defense even than they were a year ago.
And that really is hard to believe, isn't it?
Well, it is. I mean, it says a lot for their recruiting. It says a lot for the guys that have come back and done the things they've been asked to do.
Ohio State comes into the game, of course, unbeaten. There's all of the attention surrounding the game that you'll be inundated with for a week. How much of that is a distraction?
Well, I think you have to be able to, when you're getting ready to meet, when you're going out to practice, when you're down there studying film, you've got to be focused on trying to learn the game plan and get ready to play. But there's also a part of this thing that you want to enjoy.
Yeah, I mean, you want to celebrate the moment.
There's no question, because that's part of what this whole rivalry is about. There's going to be a lot of articles written, a lot of features done about former players, about there'll be talk about the great games. You played in some of those. And so all of that, immerses the whole team, the coaches, everybody in the tradition of the game.
Okay, in 30 seconds. Keys from an X's and O's standpoint. I've always said turnovers in big games make a difference in special teams.
Well, I think preparation, that's where it begins. And certainly you got to be able to take the game plan, know it, and go down and play our best game.
And manage Troy Smith.
Well, I think there's no question, but they have a lot of weapons. We gotta have a plan, and then our guys have got to execute that plan.
Well, it's going to be great, Lloyd. I wish you all the best. It's going to be fun. No matter what happens, It's been an unbelievable year, and we look for it to continue.
Well, thank you, Jim.
And we hope you're here next week as we'll talk about it all. Michigan versus Ohio State, 1 versus 2, the next game of the century. Don't miss any of it. Right here next week, same time, same place, on Michigan Replay.
Michigan Replay has been brought to you in part by Absopure Water, delivering quality bottled water since 1908. By Sirius Satellite Radio. By the University of Michigan Alumni Association, uniting the leaders in best, www.umalumni.com. By State Farm, providing insurance and financial services. And by Pontiac, official performance machines of Michigan and the NCAA.